Now, we have just a few minutes before we begin tonight, but we're going to talk a little bit about the debating process. The debating process can be something that is very formal, or it can be a less formal event. Dr. Miller is here with us, and he's our expert on the debating process. He has taught debate, and we're going to ask him a few questions about the debate. Dave, good to have you here tonight.
Thanks, Don. Great to be here.
Can you tell us tonight what the proposition of the debate is going to be, and specifically what a proposition is and what the proposition will be for this debate?
Well, a proposition is just a succinct statement that pinpoints the precise parameters of what the two contestants are debating. In this case, it's worded in kind of a negative way. Blair is technically taking the affirmative and affirming the idea that he is convinced, he knows that God does not exist. What's unusual about this debate, it's sort of a mini debate. It's not full blown, and therefore the speakers are limited time-wise. They will each have an initial 20-minute opportunity to express their perspective. Then there will be each one will receive a 10-minute rebuttal, and then that will be followed by 15 minutes of cross-examination each. And then they'll open it up to the audience to receive questions, and each of them will take turns answering, and then they will come back together and take 5 minutes each for closing statements. Whereas a normal debate or a full-blown debate might last 2 days, and each speaker would take the affirmative for maybe two nights, and then so it'd be stretched out more like a four-day occurrence.
Now, Mr. Scott has the proposition, I know that God does not exist.
Yes.
What will he have to do tonight to prove that proposition?
The impossible.
Okay.
The impossible. It's not possible to prove that. So I'm a little bit surprised that he agreed to that proposition. But, you know, the concept is you must present evidence, sufficient evidence that warrants, that demands the conclusion, I know that God does not exist. Well, to affirm that, a person would have to know everything, because the one thing they may not know is the very thing that he's affirming that he's proving. So it'll be interesting to see what tact he takes and whether or not he presents us with what at least appears to be evidence. But we know that there is no evidence that God does not exist, and all of the evidence says that God does exist. So it'll be interesting to see how he handles that.
Now, you and I have both seen debates, and you know, sometimes people will get into theatrics and name calling and a lot of things like that that really don't prove their point.
Yes.
Do you think that's good in a debate?
Oh,
does that win the audience over?
No, absolutely. Well, it may win the audience over, but the only audience that would be won over by that is an audience that's either already made up their mind and that's what they want to believe, or they are emotional in the way they approach life. In other words, we all have emotions. God created us that way, but we must set aside our emotions and allow our thinking to rule, just the way that's how God set it up. He wants the gospel to inform our thinking, and then we bring our bodily passions and emotions under the control of rational, logical thought.
Now, you mentioned logic. A lot of people don't think that logic and the Bible go together.
Hmm.
And that should be interesting tonight. I've got the idea there will be people who are present and who are watching. Logic needs to be a part of a debate. Comment on that, if you would.
Well, if you'll go to apologeticspress.org, there is an article titled Christianity is Rational. And there's a lot of detail there showing that anybody in the Bible that represented God accurately, anybody that was approved by God, used rationality, logic, and correct thinking in order to draw their conclusions.
Okay. I think it's time for us to cut and go to the debate. Thank you for tuning in.
Good evening. Welcome to the University of North Alabama. My name is Colton Scott. I am with the UNA Christian Student Center, and we want to thank you for joining us as we embark on an intellectual discussion of the utmost importance, the existence of God. On March 23rd, 2011, the American Atheist Organization began placing billboards in Des Moines, Iowa, which read, "You know there is no God, we know you are right." Tonight, Blair Scott, the communications director for American Atheist, is here to defend that position, that there is no God, while Kyle Butt from Apologetics Press will attempt to refute that position. At this time, I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to our moderator tonight, Dr. Brent Olive, who is the head of the Chemistry and Industrial Hygiene Department here at UNA. Thank you.
Thank you, and once again, welcome to the campus of the University of North Alabama, and welcome to all those watching as we live stream this via internet. You did not come to hear me, so I will be as brief as possible. I will go over the format, let you know of just a few changes that we have, and then I'll give each a formal but brief introduction. We'll begin tonight with each speaker having a 20-minute opening statement, followed by a 10-minute rebuttal. During the 20-minute opening statements, ushers will be coming through the auditorium. If you would like to ask a question of either of the two speakers, raise your hand. They will do their best to get a card to you. And during that first 40 minutes of opening statements, you'll be able to write down your question. Welcome to the campus tonight, Mr. Blair Scott, affirming the proposition that there is no God. Blair is the communications director for the American Atheist Incorporated. He is a staff writer for the American Atheist magazine and manages the No God blog, the official blog of American Atheists. He runs the Critical Eye podcast with his co-host Tom Hand. Blair recently handed over his roles as Alabama State Director and National Affiliate Director for the American Atheist to others and has passed the torch to the North Alabama Freethought Association. Blair lives in Huntsville, Alabama, where he writes a regular column on atheism for the Huntsville Times. Denying the affirmation that there is no God is Mr. Kyle Butt. He is a Christian apologist who graduated from Fried Hartman University with a BA in Bible and Communications and an MA in New Testament Studies. He has authored more than 20 books, and for over 9 years he has served as the editor for Discovery Magazine, a monthly periodical about scripture and science for 3rd through 6th grade children. Kyle has worked in the Bible department at Apologetics Press for more than a decade. That organization, Apologetics Press, is a tax-exempt, nonprofit organization dedicated to defense of New Testament Christianity. Without further delay, gentlemen, we'll begin with Mr. Kyle Butt.
I'm thrilled to be here this evening. Thank you so very much for coming and spending your very precious time with us, thinking about and discussing this topic that is of utmost importance. I'd like to thank the Christian Student Center here at UNA, and I'd also like to thank the university. As I was preparing for tonight, looking at the various things that were said, on one of the more popular social networking sites, there was a guy named Chris who was writing to Blair, and he said, "You won the debate before it started, Blair. The dude's name is Butt."
Enough said. Well, I certainly think that we can agree that the way to decide on the truth or falsity of a proposition is not based on the last name of the person who's presenting. In fact, I am confident this evening that you are here to follow with me the law of rationality. You see, the law of rationality says that we adopt only those propositions for which there is adequate evidence. And that's what we're going to be looking at this evening, evidence. We're going to speak the words of truth and reason. That's what I'm going to be speaking, and I believe that I'm going to be refuting words that don't match the truth and reason idea. But what I ask all of you to do is to honestly consider what's being said, because what we're doing here tonight is very, very important. Tonight's debate is interesting on a number of accounts. The first reason I find it so interesting is that Blair Scott is affirming this evening, there is no God. The reason that that is so interesting, there are a couple of reasons. Number one, I've never seen it done. I have viewed lots of debates on the internet. This is the second one that I have been a part of. And I've never seen an atheist stand up and say, there is no God, and I can prove that to you. Now, I'm going to be presenting two points. My first point is simply going to be, there is no good evidence for atheism. Now, Blair's colleagues understand the difficulty that he is in this evening, and let me explain to you how I know that. In one of his articles on the internet, Do Atheists Have a Bible? He says, no, of course, atheists don't have a Bible. But if I were to suggest some writings that I think might be included in a Bible, he says that he would suggest maybe some writings from people like Richard Dawkins or people like Dan Barker and several others. And Dan Barker, in the opening statements that he made in 2009 in our debate, talking about the idea of whether you can prove that there's a God or not, he said, if you are backed against the wall or backed in a corner, you cannot prove that there is no God. Richard Dawkins, in his book, The God Delusion, said this, that you cannot prove God's non-existence is accepted and trivial. He also said there on page 51, I cannot know for certain, but I think God is very improbable. You see, the reason that Blair Scott's going to have a very difficult time this evening is because affirming there is no God simply cannot be done. But what I want you to understand is that he's not going to have a difficult time doing that because he's not intelligent enough. He certainly is intelligent enough. He's not going to be able to do that, not because he's not an adequate representative of atheism. He won Atheist of the Year from the American Atheist Incorporated Association in 2007, 2010. If you were to say, does this man adequately represent atheism, you would have to agree that at least many people feel that he does. The reason that he won't be able to affirm that this evening is because it is an impossible affirmation. It simply cannot be done. So my first point is simply going to be, there is not adequate evidence to affirm there is no God. Now, my second point is going to be, there is adequate evidence to say that there is a God. And I'm just going to go through several arguments that would show that there is a God. My first argument is going to be very simply known as the cosmological argument. That's a fairly technical term that just basically means the cause and effect argument. Now, I'm going to put these in argument form and then we'll discuss them just a little bit. The first one, the cause of the universe is inexplicable without a supernatural being, the cosmological argument. In argument form, it goes like this. Everything that begins to exist must have a cause. The universe began to exist. Therefore, the universe must have a cause. You see, there are some things that we all know. We all know that nothing can cause itself. Therefore, if we have something like a natural universe, then we know that something outside of itself had to cause it. The fact that the universe had a beginning, that's indisputed. In fact, Alex Vilenkin, cosmologist from Tufts University, said this, and I quote, "It is said that an argument is what convinces reasonable men, and a proof is what it takes to convince even an unreasonable man. With that proof now in place, cosmologists no longer hide behind the possibility of a past eternal universe. There is no escape. They have to face the problem of a cosmic beginning." You see, the cosmological argument shows that if we have a material universe, which of course we do, and it did have a beginning, then it had to have some non-material cause. Therefore, in order to refute this argument, Blair would have to show that one of the premises is false. He would have to show that either the universe did not have a beginning, he would have to show that everything that has a beginning doesn't have a cause. He would have to do one of those two things, and he can do neither. Now, the second argument we'll be dealing with is known as the teleological argument. It is sometimes called the argument from design. Simply put, it says that when you see complex functionality, you know that intelligence was behind that. In argument form, it looks like this. Where there is complex functional design, there must be an intelligent designer. The universe exhibits complex functional design, therefore the universe must have an intelligent designer. The universe in which we live is extremely fine-tuned, it's intricate, it's functionally complex. And that fact is much better explained by the idea that there is a supernatural intellect behind this functional complexity. Australian astrophysicist Paul Davies made this statement in his book, The Cosmic Blueprint. He said, "There is for me powerful evidence that there is something going on behind it all. It seems as though somebody has fine-tuned nature's numbers to make the universe. The impression of design is overwhelming." Eminent Cambridge physicist Stephen Hawking wrote in his latest book, The Grand Design, he said, and I quote, "Our universe and its laws appear to have a design that is both tailor-made to support us and, if we are to exist, leaves little room for alteration. That is not easily explained and raises the natural question of why it is that way." Now let me give you just one example of this fine-tuning, this intricate design that we see in the universe. The ratio of the masses of an electron to a proton, that ratio is 1 to 1,836. That means that a proton is 1,836 times approximately larger than an electron. If you were to change the electrical charge of an electron by one part in 100 billion, then the properties that are now at play would no longer sustain the human body, and the human body would literally explode. In other words, we wouldn't be here this evening. Now, if you wanted to try to wrap your mind around one part in 100 billion, if you were to try to count to 100 billion, you would get up in the morning, count 10,000 every single day for 365 days a year, and that would take you about 27,000 years to count to 100 billion. And if you adjusted the electrical charge of the proton or an electron by that much, then what we have existing now simply could not exist. You see, such fine-tuning is manifest evidence that there is a supernatural intellect behind this. Frank Tipler, mathematical physicist from Tulane University, stated, and I quote, "When I began my career as a cosmologist some 20 years ago, I was a convinced atheist. I never in my wildest dreams imagined that one day I'd be writing a book purporting to show that the central claims of Judeo-Christian theology are in fact true. That these claims are straightforward deductions of the laws of physics as we now understand them. I have been forced into these conclusions by the inexorable logic of my own special branch of physics." You see, the intricate complexity of our universe speaks to the idea that there is a supernatural intelligence behind it all. The third argument is simply known as the moral argument. The moral argument says that there are some things in this world that are objectively morally right, and there are some things in this world that are objectively morally wrong. In argument form, it looks like this. If objective moral value exists, then God exists. Objective moral value does exist, thus God exists. Let me explain to you why this is the case. If atheism is true, and if there really is no God, then there cannot be anything that is absolutely right or wrong. Atheist William Provine from Cornell University understands this perfectly. He said it this way, and I quote, "No inherent moral or ethical laws exist, nor are there absolute guiding principles for human society. The universe cares nothing for us, and we have no ultimate meaning in life." You see, he says, if atheism is true, which he believes that it is, then there's no ultimate meaning for your existence, and there's no inherent moral absolutes. It would just depend on what would be the best for your situation at your given time, etc. As you're listening to other atheists talk about this situation, Richard Dawkins has something to say along these lines. Here's what he said. Quote, so long as DNA is passed on, it doesn't matter who or what gets hurt in the process. Genes don't care about suffering because they don't care about anything. DNA neither cares nor knows. DNA just is, and we dance to its music. This universe that we observe has precisely the properties we should expect if there is, at bottom, no design, no purpose, no evil, and no good. Nothing but pitiless indifference. You see, what he admits is, if atheism is true, ultimately, really, you can't say that something is objectively morally good or objectively morally bad. Now, Blair understands this. He has written in his article, Are Atheists Immoral? Quote, we are social animals just like ants. Take away the society and the need for justification or morality, which is a higher form of justification, goes away. Thus, if atheism were true, there would be no objective moral right or wrong. But you and I both know that there is. We know that some things are objectively morally right and some things are objectively morally wrong. It doesn't matter what society you live in. It doesn't matter at what time of human history you live. Some things are right and some things are wrong. As Michael Ruse stated very correctly, he says, the man who says that it's morally acceptable to rape little children is just as mistaken as the man who says that 2 + 2 = 5. If there are objective moral values, Dawkins, Provine, and even the implications of Blair's statement himself, that shows if there is an objective right or wrong, there has to be an objective moral standard, and it has to be something supernatural. Now, at this point, we need to understand what I'm not saying. Don't misunderstand what's being said here. I'm not saying that everybody who believes that there's a God is going to act morally. And I'm not saying that everybody who doesn't believe that there's a God cannot act in ways that are moral. What I'm saying is, if there is not a God, then there is no standard upon which to build a morality that is objective. Ultimately, all you have is your opinion versus someone else's opinion, and you can't get an objective morality without God. Now, as we look at those three main arguments, I'm also going to throw in some things here near the end of this 20-minute opening statement that is something to consider, things that the atheistic philosophy simply cannot deal with. The first thing that I'd like to throw out is that without using the idea of God, you simply cannot get human free will. Let me show you what I mean by that. In argument form, it looks like this. If humans have free will, atheism is false. Humans do have free will, therefore atheism is false. Now, let me again show you some atheists that admit this to be the case. William Provine, there again, from Cornell University, said, if you believe in evolution, you can't hope for there being any human free will. Stephen Hawking, there in the Grand Design from Cambridge, he said this. He said, do we have free will? If we have free will, where in the evolutionary tree did it develop? So it seems that we are no more than biological machines, and that free will is just an illusion. As Dawkins said, we dance to the music of the genes. You understand what that means? That means that the way we could refute atheism tonight would be very simply if we could honestly ask this question, did you personally choose to be here this evening? If you chose to be here this evening, atheism cannot be true. If atheism is true, the reason that you're here is because your genes dictated that to be the case, because there are atoms banging around in your head, and those atoms drove you here for some evolutionary reason, probably to pass on your genes in some way, and you didn't really choose to be here. Now, I want you to consider that for just a minute. Why in the world would we stand up here and have any type of discussion? Why would he present information that he thinks would support there is no God? Why would I present information that I would use to support the idea that there is a God or that he can't affirm that proposition? Why would we even be here this evening? We're here this evening because we freely chose to be. And if we really did freely choose to be, atheism simply cannot be true. Now, the second thing that I'd like to throw out here is that the origin of life under an atheistic idea simply cannot be explained. In order for atheism to be true, somehow in the past, life had to come from non-living chemicals, spontaneous generation. The irony of that is that in almost every single science textbook that you read, certainly the biological textbooks, they will say spontaneous generation was a disproven idea. But lots of times, within a paragraph or so, they will then say, but it happened in the past because now we have life. You understand that for the last 150 years, biologists have been doing scientific experiments on life. And every single one of those scientific experiments shows that in this material universe, life arises only from previously existing life of its own kind. That is the science of it. You see, in order for atheism to be true, somewhere along the line, non-living chemicals had to give rise to life. But as Martin Moe, evolutionist, stated, he said this, "A century of sensational discoveries in the biological sciences has taught us that life arises only from life." Spontaneous generation is not an idea that's yet to be proven. It's an idea that has been disproven with every biological experiment that's been done for the last 150 years. So you have atheism not being able to give you the origin of life from non-living chemicals. And finally, atheism simply cannot explain how consciousness, your ability to think about who you are, could arise from unconscious matter. There's absolutely no materialistic explanation for that. As Rutgers University professor Jerry Fedor stated, "Nobody has the slightest idea how anything material could be conscious. Nobody even knows what it would be like to have the slightest idea about how anything material could be conscious." According to a materialistic idea, you can't get consciousness coming from unconscious matter. It cannot be done. It's not as if we don't know how it was done. It cannot be done. Now, in order for Blair to shoulder his burden of responsibility, and in order for him to show you this evening there is no God, he would have to provide an adequate materialistic cause for the universe, show that the functional complexity in the universe could get here without an intelligent designer, and show us how that happened. He would have to explain away all objective morality. He'd have to show us the process by which consciousness could come from unconscious matter. And he would have to prove to us and show us the process by which life came from non-living chemicals. And he would have to explain to you that you didn't really decide to be here. That was just something that your genes told you to do. He can't give you an adequate explanation for one of those things. But in order to prove his case tonight, he would have to explain every single one of those things. It was because of evidence like this that I did not get to my final quote, because that's the time. Thanks.
Good evening, everyone. I would like to thank everyone involved, obviously too numerous to thank individually, for putting this event together. But most of all, I would like to thank you, the audience, for coming out tonight to hear this debate. Now, honestly, I'm not a huge fan of collegiate-style debates. The overwhelming majority of the audience comes with preconceived notions and leaves with the same. Now, I know I cannot change Mr. Butt's mind on this issue. He's too committed to his beliefs and invested in them, and debating him, honestly, is a waste of time. So why am I even here? I'm here for you, the audience. I'm not here to convince you that Mr. Budd is wrong, and I'm not here to convince you that I'm right. My job tonight is to confuse the living hell out of you, okay? Because I want you to go home and do the research on your own. Do not take my word for it, and do not take Mr. Butt's word for it. Go research these issues on your own. Now, Mr. Butt was going to present you, and did, with arguments for the existence of God that have been around for thousands of years. The theological arguments have not changed much over those years, and in many cases, he used scientific-sounding words to make his arguments more legitimate. But Mr. Butt mentioned that if something looks designed, it must be designed, that everything must have a first cause, that where we live in our solar system is fine-tuned, or the Goldilocks zone, that morality requires a higher being, etc. But these theological arguments have been rebutted and refuted since the ancient Greeks. They're just philosophical arguments. There's no actual evidence there. There's no scientific, tangible, put-your-hands-on evidence. It's just philosophical meandering. And I'm amazed that they're still used to this day. But then I remember that they are actually persuasive arguments. If you don't know the rebuttals and refutations, and you do not understand the advances in science and knowledge over the centuries. Now, I see no reason to refute these arguments again and bore you with the same arguments that you can see on any similar debate on YouTube. I should not have to tell you that saying our solar system is fine-tuned for the existence of humans is like a puddle of water in a street after a thunderstorm saying, "Wow, this hole is the perfect size for the amount of water I have. It's as if the hole was designed for me." I would encourage everyone to explore these theological and philosophical arguments on your own. Go home and Google them. After all, the internet is where religion goes to die. The same evidence that Mr. Butt and other apologists present is the exact same evidence that adherents of other religions give. So if you accept his evidence, then you must equally accept the evidence from Hindu, Muslim, and Wiccan apologists. The overwhelming majority of you dismiss all those other gods as mythical and non-existent. Only your God exists, and those others, they're just myths. You dismiss all those other gods and are atheistic when it comes to everyone else's gods. There are thousands of gods that you do not believe in and dismiss. The difference between you and me is that you are atheistic towards 4,000 gods. I'm atheistic towards 4,001. I want to talk about science. Now, Mr. Butt is a young earth creationist, so he is a science denier. He accepts all science, except science that disagrees with his existing beliefs and faith. He accepts a science that gives him electricity, microwave ovens, architecture, sound systems like the one in this auditorium, computers, the internet, DVDs. But when science disagrees with his belief, the science must be wrong. Now, he does not accept the science of evolution or the science of geology, and anything I say tonight is going to be lost on Mr. Butt. So I emphasize again that I'm here talking to you, the audience. Now, as he pointed out, I am in the awkward position of trying to prove a negative. And to be honest, it cannot be done except in mathematics. But we do not have to prove a negative to arrive at a reasonable conclusion that something does not exist. Now, some of my fellow atheists fall for the atheistic version of God of the gaps and say things like, "You can't say gods do not exist because we can never know for sure." Well, you would not hear the same atheists say, "You can't say leprechauns do not exist because we can never know for sure." So why do we make an exception for God beliefs when it comes to a reasonable conclusion of existence or non-existence? Sure, anything's possible. It's possible that a unicorn may walk out on the stage tonight. And it's possible that the tooth fairy will appear before us and walk on water. But possible is irrelevant. It is probable. Is it probable that a unicorn will walk out on the stage or the tooth fairy will appear before us tonight? We can reasonably say that a tooth fairy does not exist. We can trace the evolution of the tooth fairy to the Northern European tradition of tooth fae, which was a payment made when a child cut their first tooth. It's recorded in Old Norse Eder from the 13th century. Do we still leave room for, well, the tooth fairy might exist? Of course not. We all reasonably conclude that the tooth fairy does not exist. Apologies to the children in the audience. Proving the negative is not necessary when probability is so low that it's practically zero. When it comes to the gods of man's beliefs, we're supposed to make an exception of reasonable so that grant special status to the gods and make them immune to the same thinking we use to dismiss the tooth fairy, Santa Claus, leprechauns, garden fairies, unicorns, Bigfoot, the Loch Ness Monster, ghosts, psychics, homeopathy, healing crystals, and tarot cards. And when it comes to the Loch Ness Monster, scientists have shown that there's no place for a monster of Nessie size to hide in the loch, and there's an inadequate food supply for a monster of Nessie size. The photographer who took the first photo of Nessie admitted it was a hoax. Other photos have been proved to be something else or outright hoaxes. Sonar of the lock repeatedly shows nothing, and scientists have spent lots of time on a lock and never detected a thing. One can reasonably conclude, based on the lack of evidence, that the Loch Ness Monster does not exist. Proving negative is not required. And so we find ourselves looking at the lack of evidence for the existence of gods and the evidence against the existence of gods. Now, I do not want to look at tired theological arguments that the Greeks dismantled thousands of years ago. I want to look at science. Early Homo sapiens were animists. Animism is the belief that inanimate objects have spirits or souls, if you will. Everything from the rock and the lizard crawling on it to the highest mountain in the sky that it touches. Contributing spirits to the items around us was not a big leap, considering that during our evolutionary process, we had to deal with a lot of frightening things in our world. Our brains developed to what we see now, or to what we now refer to as hidden agents. Now, if you were an early human ancestor walking through the grassy plains of Africa and heard the grass rustle, your best chance of survival was to assume a hidden agent, in this case a predator, was hiding in the grass and ready to pounce, and that you should run for your life. If you fail to make that assumption, and you're wrong, you could be eaten. It is the biological evolution version of Pascal's wager. I'm sure Mr. Budd is quite familiar with Pascal's wager. Better to believe in the lion behind the grass and live than to not believe and die. Our jumpiness at things that go bump in the night is the result of millions of years of evolution. The next time you jump out of your seat while watching a horror movie to get goosebumps or walking down a dark street, you can thank the saber-toothed tiger. Now, believing in a hidden agent set the species up to believe in a hidden agent in every aspect of our world. In fact, this evolutionary adaptation is still seen in modern Homo sapiens. Hidden agent aspect leads to conspiracy theories, thinking the creaking of your house settling is caused by a ghost, or that the gods cause your grief or your success. It is the function of your primal brain that makes your skin stand on end and get goosebumps. It is a survival function of our biological brain and a byproduct of that function to assume danger in all things, to detect an agent in every action, which led to our early ancestors adapting animism. In a world full of the unexplainable, a world without science, how can you blame our earliest ancestors for seeing agents in the dangerous world they lived in? Who could blame them for wondering what they did wrong when the agents brought an earthquake or a volcanic eruption? They began asking how they could please the agents to avoid disasters and misery in their lives. It was not long before our ancestors developed rituals to appeal to the hidden agents. Once our ancestors began rituals to and for these agents' appearance, once they began singing songs to them, dancing for them, trying to appease them, under our modern definition, they were worshiping gods. And it wasn't too long, historically speaking that is, that the spirits became more godlike and were thought to directly answer these songs and prayers. The spirits could listen and intervene in our ancestors' lives, and polytheism was born. Now, these were gods for everything: lightning, thunder, volcanic eruptions, rain, the sun, the moon, wind, etc. And over the course of polytheistic evolution, the spirit gods became less spirit and more god and began to really be anthropomorphized by our ancestors, to the point that the gods not only began to look human and have human physical features, but human emotions as well. How can we look at a god who is jealous, vengeful, angry, misogynistic, warring, and petty, and not see the man-made influence in his personality? The multitude of gods began to narrow down to key gods until ultimately monotheism began. Now, around 12,000 years ago, our ancestors went through what scientists call the Neolithic Revolution. This is when the first villages and towns really began to materialize and organized religion became more obvious in our cultures, art, architecture, etc. And when I say organized religion, I mean in the modern sense of the word, not just rituals and rites and beliefs, but a well-established hierarchy to dictate those beliefs, rituals, and rites. The Neolithic Revolution, of course, was tied directly to the discovery of agriculture and irrigation. So, in a sense, modern religion owes its very existence to the scientific discovery of agriculture. Now, as our ancestors changed their lifestyle and resided with more of their fellow Homo sapiens, the more that their religious beliefs evolved. Groups within the culture began aligning themselves with one of the polytheistic gods more than the others, and we begin to see the early stages of monotheism develop within the polytheistic societies. Excuse me for just 1 second. My apologies. As one of the gods within the pantheon became the main god and began to be worshipped more than the other gods, those other gods began to fall away as each generation progressed, until there were no gods left except the main god. The ancient Jewish mystics were polytheistic. Yahweh was just one of many gods, but he was their main god, their Zeus, if you will. The story of the Ten Commandments is a great example of a polytheistic society becoming monotheistic. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord, Lord thy God, am a jealous God. It doesn't say I'm the only God. It says don't have any more before me. The Ten Commandments relegated the pantheon of Jewish mystic gods to the back of the bus and placed Yahweh at the front of it. And within generations, those other gods were forgotten and abandoned. We know how religion evolved and how theology shaped over the eons. We have a relatively clear path to follow. We have a basic understanding of why religious thought evolved. Evolution clearly shows us that religion and belief in God is a man-made, or more appropriately, brain-made system, which was exacerbated and promulgated thanks to the Neolithic Revolution. But what does neuroscience and evolutionary biology have to say about this? And one of the examples of proof of God from layman religious people as well as apologists is near-death experiences, or NDEs. I've read about NDEs from almost every single religious belief system. If NDEs are proof of your God, then they are equally proof of everyone else's. Science has shown that NDEs are nothing more than a brain function. They're biological, not paranormal. NDE experiences can be duplicated with drugs or electrical stimulation applied to specific parts of the human brain. Scientists first started looking into this when Navy and Air Force pilots reported having NDEs during high-G testing in the centrifuge. Pilots would lose consciousness and begin to see a tunnel of light and felt like they were beginning pulled towards it. They reported feeling euphoria, and some pilots reported hearing voices. Studies show that during times of crisis, trauma, or extreme conditions, the brain releases as much as 10 times the normal level of hormones. These hormones act very similar to a narcotic in the brain by reducing pain stimuli to the nerve center. Defenders of NDEs claim that people in surgery report seeing exact tools and procedures and would give descriptions of rooms that they could have never known. Now, we'll ignore the fact that thanks to television, most of our society knows exactly what an operating room looks like and the general lingo used in a hospital. So how do you test whether or not people are actually seeing the room or just dreaming about a scene from the TV series ER or House? A nurse came up with a good idea. Put sticky notes on the top of the lights and instruments with very specific messages. And researchers interviewed post-op patients and, not a one of them saw the sticky notes. Even when the research asked them specifically about the notes, not a one saw the sticky notes. And the researchers also noted that most of the details that the patients gave were simply wrong. One thing is for sure, everyone who has reported an NDE was not actually dead. They were only experiencing the first stages of death. No one is returned from being dead. If your heart stops or you're stopped breathing, you're not dead. You have to be, in order, your brain has to stop. That's clinical death. The only way an NDE can be reported is if the brain is still functioning, coping with the trauma it is being dealt and doing what it can to protect the body it is attached to. Another recent study showed that when test subjects viewed religious items, the parts of the brain they reacted most were dedicated to emotion, self-representation, and cognitive conflict. This is in contrast to viewing ordinary facts when the most active part of the brain is memory retrieval networks. In other words, the primitive parts of the brain, the limbic system, are most closely related to religious belief. Now, this is not surprising when you understand that religious thought is a byproduct of human evolution. Another study looked at religious believers who said they were feeling the spirit or felt the hand of God. Religious believers from different religions were studied, and during these experiences, they found the exact same physiological reactions found in people who attended rock concerts, or bungee jumped, or went skydiving, or by a sports fanatic attending a home game. They found a slight increase in body temperature, slightly elevated heart rate, slightly elevated blood pressure, an increase in dopamine in the system, flushing of the skin, and sometimes even sexual arousal. The same thing happens to us during fight or flight. Another religious experience has been scientifically shown to be nothing more than a biological function. Scientists also know that people who suffer from epilepsy are more likely to be religious than other persons, because an epileptic seizure brings religious thought to the forefront. Brain scans of epileptic patients going through a seizure show the exact same limbic system active when they report a highly religious experience. Again, science has shown that a religious experience is nothing more than biological. When you combine many of the aspects of evolution in our brain, which most are still exist in our physiology, then you begin to understand why religious thought exists, why people experience what we call spirituality, why we believe what they do. Neuroscience has opened up a whole new understanding of religious belief in Homo sapiens. Research has also shown that religious believers are actually not stupid, like a lot of atheists probably suggest online. Okay? Religious people are doing exactly what their biology has evolved to do. Religious belief has nothing to do with intelligence. Religious belief is a physiological function. That function cannot be overridden, or it can be overridden, but not turned off. Another item that helps us understand just how much religious thought and belief in the hidden agent we call God are simply biological brain functions is Asperger's, or Asperger's. The percentage of people with Asperger's within the general population is around 4%. Within the atheist community, the percentage of people with Asperger's is in the double digits. Individuals who have Asperger's are less likely to believe in a God because the part of the brain that is used to have religious thought, to think teleologically, and connect with the hidden agent does not properly work. This is especially true of the emotional connection aspect of religion, which is dominant in the limbic system. If belief in God was not in our heads, then we would not see brain damage or Asperger's or similar diseases cause a reduction in God belief and religious experiences. Then there's also pareidolia. Pareidolia is our brain trying to make sense of what we see when what we're looking at makes no sense. The brain returns to what it knows in order to make the world it sees fit into its existing parameters. It sees patterns and recognizes shapes where there are none. This is why we see the face on Mars when one doesn't actually exist. It is why we see faces and other shapes in the patterns of hardwood floors and the bark of trees. It's why we see Ben Franklin, dragons, and Mickey Mouse in the random shapes of clouds. And it's why we see Jesus in a tortilla, the Virgin Mary in a potato chip, Buddha in a tree knot, and Abraham Lincoln on a cliff in New Hampshire. Pareidolia is why we see patterns in design where there are none. And when taking into consideration the advances of neuroscience, the physiology of the hidden agent, the function of pareidolia, and the knowledge of the evolution of religious thought in our species and our ancestors, then you can reasonably conclude that the gods do not exist. Especially when you take into account that there is zero evidence of a god existing. Not a single religion has ever proved that their gods have existed or do exist. All they have is faith, which, by the way, is another biological function of our brain. The fact that we know how religious thought evolved in our species thanks to archaeology and other sciences only solidifies the reasonableness of coming to the conclusion that gods do not exist. Belief in the gods will not go away until our brains evolve and get rid of many of the limbic system leftovers that lend to religious thought within Homo sapiens. Until then, we can override many of these basic biological brain functions through the use of other parts of our brain, our higher thinking and critical thinking skills. It is the same basic brain function that lends to belief in homeopathy, Bigfoot, conspiracy theory thinking, and much more. All failures of critical thinking, but successes of brain biology and physiology. It is up to us as individuals to evaluate our beliefs and apply critical thinking to them. All of them. Not just our belief in gods, but our beliefs in the supernatural, paranormal, everyday events, political beliefs, etc. Every day you watch television, marketers are taking advantage of your limbic system and your basic biological brain function and psychology. It takes critical thinking to not want to go out and buy that new pseudoscientific medicine that claims to cure one ailment or another, and to actually look at the research and studies. It takes the same effort to override our instinct, if you will, to believe in the hidden agent we call gods. We cannot prove a god does not exist any more than we can prove that leprechauns do not exist. But the burden of proof is not on me. But we can say, with a high level of reasonability, that the existence of all man's gods is improbable, and reasonably assert that the gods do not exist. As Delos McCone once said, the invisible and the non-existent look very much alike. And if the evidence were to ever change, then so would my view. Thank you.
Honestly, Blair did about the only thing that he could do this evening and concede defeat at the outset and say, I'm just not going to deal with your arguments. I halfway expected that And I want you to know that that's not the face that he put on with the people who were showing him that you can't affirm a negative like that. One of his fellow atheists, Derek Johnson, on one of the networking sites on the internet said, "Blair, you can't affirm a negative." And here's a quote from Blair. He said, "I don't fall for the atheist version of the God of the gaps, which is what this nonsense is, that we can't prove God doesn't exist. I disagree and think you can prove that gods do not exist." Now, Blair's job tonight was to stand before you and give you evidence as to why he knows for a fact there is no God. You saw that he did not do that. Why didn't he do that? Because it can't be done. It's never been done. Blair was supposed to do that. He said he would do that. He put his name on a proposition that said, "I will do that," and he didn't do it, and he admitted he couldn't do it in the first 3 minutes of his speech. What did Blair then admit? "I've lost. I can't do what I said I could do, and technically, Kyle, it's yours." Well, I want that for the record, just on, that yes, that's exactly what he admitted, and that's exactly what's happened. Now, let's move to a new debate that he has now suggested. "Okay, Kyle, I've lost that one. I know that I can't do that. Here now I'm going to say, though, that there are no good arguments for theism." And here's what he did. The strongest arguments for theism that he admits have been around for thousands of years that have never successfully been refuted. Now, he doesn't admit they've never been successfully been refuted. He does admit that they have been around. They've been around because they haven't successfully been refuted. Here's what he says. "I'm not going to deal with that, but I am going to really nail down this idea of near-death experiences." Yeah, that was his evidence, at least a large part of his evidence for the idea that there is no God. Now, I'm not going to take a poll. It would be a straw poll in this instance. But if I were to say, how many of you in here are sitting here and have a belief in God because you have founded that on a near-death experience? I dare say the vast majority of you would absolutely positively say, "No, I'm not founding my belief on a near-death experience. I'm founding my belief in God on truth and reason, and the evidence that I presented is still just as valid as it was before Blair got up," and you noticed he didn't even try to deal with it. Now, he gives us some ideas. He said, "Look, I'm not up here to tell you that I'm right and to tell you that Kyle's wrong. I'm here to confuse you." I think he did a great job with that as far as the debate is going, insofar as looking at the ideas. But here's what I want you to get out of that statement. He says, "I want you to research it for yourself." Yes, that's exactly what we want you to do. In fact, we want you to follow truth and reason and accept the law of rationality. Now, my final quote on my opening statements was from the man who has the most widely published atheistic philosophy for the last 100 years. For 10 decades, Anthony Flew had the atheistic paper that was the most widely distributed in the entire world, not in our country, in the entire world for 100 years. And here's what he said at the end or near the end of his life. He said, and I quote, "I have followed the argument where it has led me, and it has led me to accept the existence of a self-existent, immutable, immaterial, omnipotent, and omniscient being." What did he say he did? Follow the argument where it led him. And where did it lead him? Where it will always lead an honest, objective observer of this evidence to the conclusion that there has to be a first cause, it has to be supernatural, and it has to be intelligent, and it has to have a morality about it. Now, he is right in the sense that we haven't gotten into the God of the Bible. No, we certainly haven't gotten into the God of the Bible. We could do that if we had time. That's not what the debate was on, and we could show that there is a good reason for rejecting the 4,000 gods and accepting the one. That would be like asking Thomas Edison. They said, "Thomas Edison, when you went to invent the light bulb, you failed 10,000 times. He said, "No, I didn't fail 10,000 times. I successfully found 10,000 things that don't work in a light bulb." Well, you can successfully find 4,000 gods or however many else gods there are that don't adhere to following the law of rationality, following truth and reason. Now, let's get to a little bit of what he said about, here's how we know, he says, that the idea of God simply is not right. He says, because it's a product of evolution. Now, let's think about that for a second. He stood here tonight and said, we know that there is not a God because the idea of a God is the product of evolution. In order for him to get to the idea of evolution, number one, he's got to get a materialistic cause. Number two, he has to get life from non-life. Number three, he has to get consciousness from unconscious matter. And then he might could even start talking about evolution. Now, he said, I can't prove that the idea of God is not true, but I can suggest there's a high probability that it's not. Well, how high of a probability are we talking about here? Let me tell you about high probabilities. In their book, The Anthropic Cosmological Principle, John Barrow and Frank Tipler said, the odds for assembling a single gene are between 4 to the negative 180th power and 4 to the negative 360th power. He says, you know what, we don't believe in God because it's just not very probable. There's not a high probability of it. Do you understand the ridiculous nature of the probability of assembling a single gene? There are only 10 to the positive 80th, 10 with the script there of 80. That's all the electrons there are in the entire known universe. And the chance that a gene evolved, according to John Barrow and Frank Tipler, is 4 to the negative 180th power, an extra 100 powers on there. If you want to talk about dismissing something on improbability, well, let's do that. Let's dismiss stuff that's improbable and dismiss evolution and dismiss life coming from non-life and dismiss the ridiculous idea of a singularity some 13.7 billion years ago. Let's do dismiss stuff that's improbable, and what will you get back to? You'll get back to the idea that there is a supernatural, self-existent, eternal mind behind it all. Now, let's also show what the problem here with Blair's thinking is as far as, well, the idea of God is evolutionary. And he says, we're not going to get rid of the idea of God until our brains evolve far enough and into such complexity that they evolve past the idea of God. Where did he get the idea that there is no God? Where did that come from? You see, what Blair has just suggested to you is commonly referred to as a genetic fallacy. That's the idea that you can dismiss something based on where it came from. Even if Blair could show that evolution is true, which he cannot, even if he could show that you can get life from non-life, which he cannot, he would then have to prove, oh, by the way, there can't be a God that would put that idea into the human mind. He can't do that. But then not only would he have to prove that there is not a God that put that idea into the human mind, then he would have to also prove that humans can't look at things and come to the truth or reality based on what they see. Can you look at the intricate design in the universe and realize there has to be a supernatural designer behind it? Certainly you can. Can you look at the idea that there is objective moral value and realize that there is objective moral standard that has to be based on God? Absolutely you can. Now let's use Blair's thinking just for a minute. If the idea of God should be dismissed because it's a product of evolution, and Blair himself is a product of evolution, and he is suggesting the idea that there's no God, where did that idea come from? Follow the thought, evolution. And so using his thinking, what should we do with the idea that there's not a God based on where it came from? We should dismiss it. You see that thinking like that simply cannot carry the burden of God does not exist. Thank you.
I had actually wanted originally to concede my rebuttal time in order to allow 10 more minutes of audience Q&A, but I've been asked not to do that, so I will do my rebuttal. One of the things that you noticed is strategy. Strategy is important here, okay? Because strategy sets the tone. Now, what Mr. Butt did is what we in the skeptical community call shotgun tactics. What that is he puts a bunch of things out there, knowing I have no way to respond to all of them, which means you're going to walk out of here. Even if I respond to 10 of 13 or 10 of 20, you're going to walk out of here going, well, he didn't respond to those other 10, so Kyle must be right. There's no way I can respond to all of them. As somebody once said, for every sentence of lie requires two paragraphs of truth. Hey, there's no way I can actually go through the cosmological, the teleological, the moral argument. There's no way. There's not enough time to go through all of those and dismiss those properly. So again, I would ask you to go home and do the research. Look these up. I mean, these are simple arguments. What he mentioned tonight was the cosmological, the teleological, the ontological, the anthropic, the moral, and I think he touched a little bit on the transcendent argument and argument from degree. That's it. That's all he touched on. These are philosophical discussions. There's no evidence there. He didn't present a single bit of evidence for his God. Now, see, here's the other thing, right? He goes off and talks about on and on and on about how, you know, how you can't prove your point. Apparently, my bantering back and forth with friends on my comments is something I'm being held to the fire on. Okay, so be it. I accept that responsibility. I probably shouldn't have said that. But here's the thing, okay? I didn't pick the subject matter. Apologetics Press did. And why did they intentionally pick the subject matter of God does not exist? Because he knows, just like I can't prove a negative, he can't prove the positive. He has no evidence. If there was evidence for God, we wouldn't have been arguing about this for the last 12,000 years. These arguments have existed for thousands of years, and unlike what Mr. Butt said, I did state specifically that the Greeks dismantled them, and they've been dismantled ever since. Just pick up any book. Just go to Google and look this stuff up. They've been dismantled. They're philosophical arguments. That's it. There's not a single shred of physical evidence. It's the ABC logical fallacy. A exists, B exists, therefore A exists. It's a logical fallacy because it starts with a false premise. And what you're hearing is a bunch of straw man arguments. That's all you're hearing. Like this idea that getting back to the eternal mind, and again, it goes to evidence and all these things. Or the NDEs, mentioning all he talked about was NDEs. No, that's not all I talked about. And you know that's not all I talked about. But that's a straw man argument. And congratulations on getting the laugh. I approve that. I thank you for the joke about, you know, confusing you. Because I hope you're confused. I want you to be confused. If I confused you, then I did a good job tonight. Because I want you to go home and do this on your own. Look at this information. The information is out there. There's not enough time to cover any of this. To not even touch it. To barely scratch the surface. What we're talking about tonight is literally the tip of the iceberg. You know, the information out there is amazing. It really is. And I encourage you guys to go look at it and go find it. You know, Anthony mentioned Anthony Flew. I mean, that's argument from authority. That's a logical fallacy. You know, congratulations, one scientist became a Christian. You know, the bottom line is when you read Anthony Flew and you read him, what he talks about, this, he presents equally no evidence for his conclusion. He fell for the philosophical arguments. No physical evidence. Anthony Flew doesn't present any physical evidence. He can't. You cannot prove a God exists. We wouldn't be having this discussion if you could. What we're talking about is essentially God of the gaps. That's really what it boils down to. We don't know how the universe began, therefore God did it. We don't know how life started, therefore God did it. Well, it used to be, we don't know how lightning strikes, therefore God did it. As science and knowledge increases, God of the gaps shrinks. And it's irresponsible to assume that where our knowledge doesn't exist, insert God here. Because sooner or later, God's going to disappear from that gap too. Just as he has over the eons as our knowledge has increased. Thank you. All right, so I guess I get to start?
Yes, sir.
Fair enough. Is everybody having a good time so far, at least?
Yeah. All right.
Mr. Butt, I was wondering if you could tell me, because you mentioned the morality argument. Is it immoral to rape a woman?
Absolutely.
And how do you know that?
I know that because there is an objective morality that's based in the nature of God, and that nature of God would never permit such abuse on another human.
And yet Deuteronomy says, if a man is caught in the act of raping a young woman who is not engaged, he must pay 50 pieces of silver to the father, and then he must marry the young woman because he violated her, and she will never be allowed to divorce her, or he will never be allowed to divorce her. So the Bible tells you that if you rape a woman, your punishment is you get to marry her. If that's where our morality comes from, you can keep it. But it gets worse, right? I mean, it gets worse because if you're raped outside the city and you don't scream, it's your fault as the woman because you didn't scream and get help and you get to be stoned to death.
Is that a question?
Yeah. How is this morality? If you're, I'm assuming you're a Christian. I mean, because you have the Bible with you, you work, your Bible part of Apologetics Press. So your morality doesn't just come from God; it comes from the Bible, right?
Okay, now let's step back just a minute. The discussion about the Bible morality has nothing whatsoever to do with the proposition there is a God or there's not.
If one of your arguments is that morality, it says, the reason there's morality is there is a God, it absolutely does.
Okay, it doesn't, but I've got no problem answering the question. I'll be more than happy to, and honestly, this is the direction I figured that it would go due to the fact that I figured there's no way we could have stayed with the original proposition. Now, when he says, if a person rapes someone, then he has to marry her, etc. Notice that, number one, I would like to know the translation of the Bible that he's using in that case, because I've never seen a translation that is a standard translation that uses the word rape in that case. Now, what I have seen is if a man lies with a woman in this instance or in that instance. So he would have to first show that this is talking about something that was non-consensual. And I don't think biblically that he can do that. But secondly, there's something that you need to understand as far as this goes. God has never condoned the abuse of another person. If someone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. Now, God is giving an instruction in that instance, but it's not that he condones the person slapping someone on the right cheek. He's saying this is how you deal with it if it actually happens, and there are going to be abuses to humanity, but you don't condone the wrong action. And when it says, bless those who curse you, do good to those who spitefully use you, etc., he's not saying, oh, it's a good thing they're spitefully using you. There's a good thing they're cursing you. But he's saying, if this happens, which sometimes there are going to be abuses to humanity, here's how you deal with it.
Now, throughout the night, you've clearly gone over the standard philosophical arguments, as I've mentioned several times. Do you actually have any physical evidence of God existing?
Yes.
By all means, present it.
Let me read for you, if I can find it here, a quote from, here's what Richard Dawkins says. In his book, The God Delusion, he says that physically touching something most of the time has been viewed in the scientific world as that's how you prove something, but he says, often, inference from available evidence is dismissed as unscientific. But he said, I'm not about to say that inference to the best explanation is more or less powerful than physically touching something. Now, you understand what I mean by that.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Because
I agree.
You would suggest that, hey, there was a singularity 13.7 billion years ago, and we've never seen the singularity. We just see the stuff that supposedly came from that singularity, and we extrapolate back to that. So if you're going to say we're going to use stuff that we see to extrapolate back to something that we don't see, well, that's exactly what the biblical writer did there in Romans chapter 1, where he said, for since the beginning of creation, God's invisible attributes, stuff you don't see, is clearly understood, being understood by the things which are made, things that you do see. So I would suggest, yeah, we got all kinds of physical evidence. Physical evidence, number one, we have complex functionality in the universe that cannot be explained any other way, and we know that complex functionality of that nature comes from a mind. We also have objective morality. We also have a universe that has to have a supernatural explanation. And so I would say, yes, you look at those things and extrapolate back to the original source.
Again, you're jumping to a conclusion without the, you know, without the actual evidence. I agree that inferring is possible. I have no problem with inferring, but you can't infer if you start with a false premise. And you move the goalpost constantly. That's the problem that I see with all of these philosophical arguments. And philosophical arguments are not evidence that you can infer from. And this idea of design, you know, if, when you add the supernatural aspect to it, you're violating Occam's razor at that point. You're not taking the simplest explanation. So I would ask you, if this idea of design means that there has to be a designer, that also, you know, is falling on the cosmological argument, who is God's cosmological argument? Or what is God's cosmological argument? Another, what the premise is that in order for something to be created, the creator has to be equally or more complex than the creation. So if God created this massive, expansive universe and all this vast space for just Lee Whittle-Uz and this little solar, little tiny part of the solar system, who created God? I mean, that's a kindergarten argument, but if the cosmological argument says there has to be a greater creator, then God himself is intelligently designed. God himself shows design and must need an intelligent designer.
You are right. I do think it's a kindergarten argument. Let me read to you a quote, and no offense personally to you by that. I just think that's one that has.
Oh, no, I agree. It is a kindergarten argument.
Great.
You know, same thing with, you know, well, can God make a stone, you know, heavier than it
right.
can lift?
But right. Now, let me respond to it there. Richard Dawkins, in his book, The Greatest Show on Earth, said, obviously, the vast majority of evolution is invisible to direct eyewitness observation. With evolution, as with continental drift, inference after the event is all that is available to us for the obvious reason that we didn't exist until after the event. Now, here is where the idea that God has to have a cause breaks down. It breaks down in that we understand scientific laws based on the physical, material, natural universe that we study. So what we can know about the material naturalistic world does not then extend to a supernatural world. So the reason that you don't use the law of cause and effect on God is because God is not natural. He is supernatural. And so what we can say then is, we know that this universe couldn't cause itself. We know that it had a beginning and it had to have a cause. We know that material entities cannot cause themselves, so there has to be a cause. Where? Supernaturally. That's where it has to come from. Ultimately, you have to get to something that does not obey the law of cause and effect, and it has to be something that's not natural.
So God is supernatural, and how convenient for him. So he's outside the realm of basically understanding and testing, which if he's outside the realm of testing, he's kind of irrelevant.
So, can I respond to that real quick?
Yeah, by all means, please.
Okay. In your article, where did it all come from? You said a singularity means that we don't have knowledge to go any further. Nevertheless, the bottom line is that we don't know 100%. In other words, before 1 times 10 to the negative 43rd after the Big Bang, we don't know what was before it. Has anybody ever tested anything about a singularity as far as touching it, tasting it, feeling it, or smelling it, a singularity like the Big Bang?
No, it's inferred.
Okay, so would you then say, well, that must be irrelevant?
It is until we know about it, yes. But that's the point. You're right. It is irrelevant until we know about it, but that's the point of science. That's where science and religion disagree. You made the claim that God exists, period, end of discussion. There's no reason to scientifically evaluate him because we can't, because he's supernatural. He's outside the realm of understanding and science, and he doesn't apply to the physics and laws that I demand that you, Blair Scott, stick to. Okay? But what you're talking about with science is that we don't know is an acceptable answer to scientists. Because we don't know means let's ask more questions, let's find out, let's bridge that gap, and let's discover it. So it is irrelevant until we find out the actual information. That's the point of science, and that's the difference between religion and science. You know, let's go back to objective morality for a second, if you don't mind. Okay. If objective morality requires a God, and it requires this God to have some type of standard, does it not? So does God set the standard, or does God get the standards from somewhere else?
Great question. It's called the Euthyphro problem, and it's very simply answered in this. God's nature dictates the standard. Just like the Bible says, God cannot lie. There's not a standard of truth out there that's above God, neither does God arbitrarily decide, oh, I'm going to say that today lying is not something that we should do. In essence, there is a nature that flows from God. It's part of his nature. So God doesn't lie because it would go against his nature, and that's where morality comes from.
It's called the Ten Commandments, not the Ten Moral Guidelines. They are commandments to you. They're not, hey, here's some guidelines, make sure you follow these and be good to each other. Morality is not objective. Just 150 years ago, we were marrying our daughters off at their first menstrual cycle. Why don't we do that anymore? Did God come down and give us a new objective morality about young girls and when the proper marrying age is? No. We as a society modified our morality. We changed our view about morality. We stepped above religious morality that is stagnant and became true moral people. And there's plenty of examples of this. Slavery, the abolition of slavery, women's rights and women's suffrage, getting rid of child labor in industrial parks, all of these things. No God came down and said, you know what, I've changed my mind about this objective reality. This is the new rule from now on. No, we as a society did that. So did your God come down and change the rules on us? How is it objective if the rules change over time? If this moral, our societal morals change over time?
Sure. Let me comment on his statement. He said, look, objective morality is not really the case. As we evolve, as we move on, as we progress, the stuff that we thought was moral back then changes. So what he's then saying, remember the Michael Ruse quote, the person who says that it's all right, morally acceptable to rape a six-year-old is just as wrong as the person who says 2 + 2 = 5. What he's saying is, no, it would be all right under certain circumstances if eventually we evolve to a place where society thinks that this particular moral atrocity would be all right. That would be okay, and so we just follow wherever we evolve. Now, his question, did God come down and change the morality? No, and here's what he's missing. You can change laws, as in the Old Testament and the New Testament, but the morality behind those laws does not alter. For instance, in the Old Testament, it was always wrong to abuse another human and not to grant them basic human rights. Now, in the New Testament, it is equally as wrong to do that. Our founding fathers understood that perfectly. They said there in the Declaration of Independence, we hold these truths to be self-evident. Self-evident to everybody that we are created and are endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights. So if what we're saying is, can God from the Old Testament to the New Testament make a different regulation that still is in perfect alignment with not abusing people? Well, then yes. That would simply be like saying on a certain highway, it's all right to go 65. If there's road construction, you need to go 45 because there are going to be people there whose lives might be in danger. Yes, you could change the speed limit, but the morality behind that is the preservation of the people working and the preservation of the people driving down. You didn't change the morality. All you did was change the regulation. All right. Now, Blair, on several occasions, and I have this from some of your writings and things like that, in your Lake Hypatia speech, July 4th, 2010, you said that sometimes a good tactic to use when talking to Christians is to say that you are a Christian and that you're just struggling with some ideas and to lie to them and not tell them that you're an atheist. And in your article, Employee Lounge Blasphemy, Tales of a Coffee Cup, you told about a discussion you had with a lady in office there, and you said, while the religious paraphernalia did not offend me, I told her that it did. Do you still think it's morally acceptable to lie to further atheism?
Well, actually, the example you gave the first time was an idea I presented to people that are coming out of the closet, that if it may be best to play Doubting Thomas at first in order to avoid repercussions. So that wasn't... I would not use that method to convert. That's a method that I would recommend people who are in the closet, scared to come out of it, play the role of Doubting Thomas for a while, and then once they're comfortable with that and realize, okay, you know, and they start to think, okay, clearly this person is losing their religion, when you come out of the closet, it's not this huge psychological blow to your mom or dad, basically. No, there's no reason to lie in order to further atheism. What was the second point?
You said while the religious paraphernalia did not offend me, I told her it did.
Yeah, that was not actually lying to promote atheism. That was lying to prove a point, which was the correct moral thing to do at that point. Because morality is situational. And that particular point, this woman was demanding, for those that don't know, this woman was demanding that I get rid of my evolution coffee mug because it offended religious people in the office. That's violating my civil rights. That's a religious discrimination lawsuit for the begging. Now, she wasn't going to understand that because she was willing to kick that out of the office when I'm surrounded by all these religious icons and paraphernalia. So do I fight this and go to court and make a big legal brouhaha out of it, which I can't even afford to do? Or do I just say, okay, if you remove the religious paraphernalia as well, because they equally offend me?
Okay, so you think it's morally permissible to lie to prove a point. Is that what I got out of that? You think it's all right to lie to prove a point?
It depends. It's really a case-by-case situation. It is situational ethics.
All right, have you lied to us tonight to prove any point?
Not that I'm aware of.
All right. Where do you go from there?
You're having entirely too much fun, Kyle.
Okay, let's look at this idea again of proving that there is a God based on what you can touch, see, taste, hear, or smell. Do you believe that life came from non-life?
I don't believe it, no. Belief is irrelevant. Right now, the answer is we don't know, and that's an acceptable answer from the scientific standpoint. We don't know, and that's why we're looking at it, and that's why labs are doing all the research that they can to discover it. And recently, labs have created synthetic life, and labs have also created the very foundations of amino acids within labs as well. So we're actually getting there. We're making progress.
So,
and when I say we, I mean scientists,
right,
not me.
You say that in science writings and in your writings, you say, we don't know that life came from non-life. Is that what you say when you write?
That is the acceptable answer at this point, that we really don't know. We can speculate, we can hypothesize, we can discuss, you know, hypotheticals, we can talk about what the common hypothesis and what the common thinking is right now, but when you really boils down to it, we don't know the answer, and that's okay.
Okay, in most of your writings, and I just from most of the scientific writings that I have seen, like Dawkins and the rest of the what I would call the four horsemen and the other guys in the atheist community, they do say, we know somewhere in the past life came from non-life. They say, we don't know how it did, but we know that it did. In fact, when you wrote in your article, where did it all come from? And you said, we know what happened all the way back to 10 to the negative 43 seconds, but we don't know after that. Now, you said we know...
We don't know before that.
Before that, rather. You said we know what happened back to 10 to the negative 43 seconds.
Correct.
Now, life coming from non-life would be from 10 to the negative 43 seconds on forward.
Yes.
So are you telling us you know what happened yet?
Well, one, that's a straw man.
From your writing.
No. Your argument is a straw man, but that's okay.
How is it a straw man?
When you're talking about knowing... When you're talking about knowing cosmological, that's different from biological. You're talking about two separate issues, and you're trying to combine them in one and make a mockery of it, which is called a straw man argument. Go to any encyclopedia online and actually look up logical fallacies, and you'll see all of them that Mr. Budd has made tonight.
Okay, all right. As you're talking about the idea that morality evolves and that in a while our morality might change based on the movement of the genes in our brain, do you think you freely chose to be here tonight?
Absolutely.
Okay, now, Dawkins, Hawking, Barker, the guys that you said you might include in the atheistic Bible said, Provine, and numerous others, said you can't have free will if atheism is true. You just disagree with those guys?
Yeah, actually I do.
Okay.
I do disagree with them because it's not just a matter of genes. Genes tell us what our body shape is going to look like and give us our basic characteristics. On top of that, there's the nurture versus nature argument and how who we are as an individual is affected. And as individuals, we all make choices based on that individual part of who we are, our conscious, if you will, or as religious people would call it, our soul, okay? That is who we are. That's what makes us, and that's how we make our decisions. Now, are there some aspects of our life that are kind of predestined genetically, if you will? Of course there are. But when it comes down to a lot of our personal choices, I absolutely do think we have a free will, and I do disagree with those men, because I don't fall from argument from authority.
Okay, absolutely. And you mentioned the idea that I had used the quote from Flew and was appealing to authority. I certainly wasn't. What I was just saying was that quote embodied what I will hope people here would do is follow the evidence where it leads. Now, you said in your previous statements, belief in gods will not go away until our brains evolve. So if you say, well, we've got free will, but belief in gods will not go away until our brains evolve, how do you put those two statements together?
I already said you have the genetic side of it, and then you also have the nature versus nurture. Okay, so the genetic part, the limbic system of our brain, which makes us preset, if you will, to have religious or spiritual beliefs, is inherent in us. Okay, so then it comes down to nature versus nurture. You're all Christians, not because Christianity is true. You're all Christians because you don't live in Tel Aviv. You're all Christians because you don't live in Tehran. And you're all Christians because you don't live in Sri Lanka. If you lived over there, you would be Hindus, Muslims, Buddhists, or whatever. That is the nature versus nurture. You're predestined to believe in God, but you're a victim of geography. You're a Christian because you were born and raised in the United States, which is predominantly Christian.
Where were you born and raised?
I was born in Mobile, Alabama, but lived there for about 2 months and went all over the world in the United States. I've been everywhere, including the Middle East, North Africa, Europe.
Okay, so if we have an atheist in the audience that was born and raised in the United States of America, if you say a person's a Christian because they're born and raised in the United States of America, why would you say a person's an atheist because they're born in the United States of America?
Because they left religion. They are an example. They are an example of what I was talking about, using the critical thinking aspects of our biology to override our basic instinct. Just like there are atheists in Tehran and atheists in Sri Lanka. But, of course, if you're an atheist in Tehran, chances are you're probably going to get killed if anybody finds out.
Are there Christians in those areas? Tehran,
yes.
And those? Okay. So
a minority, but they're there.
Have used their critical thinking skills to overcome the religion that they were born into and to follow the evidence where it leads? Is that what you're saying?
No, I wouldn't say that, because the Christians, for example, in Egypt, the Coptic Christians are a good example of what you're talking about. Those born into Coptic Christianity will become Coptic Christians. In order to get to the premise of what you're talking about, you'd have to go back hundreds and hundreds, if not even 1,000 years, to go back to when Christians first moved into Egypt and established the Coptic Christian community. Are there converts? Absolutely there are. Muslims become Christians, Christians become Muslims, Buddhists become Hindus, Hindus become Zoroasters. Yeah, there's absolutely cross-pollination, if you will. That occurs, but it doesn't occur in massive droves. How many, let's figure this out. How many in the audience have changed their religion at least once in their lifetime? Point proved.
Okay, now you said if a Coptic Christian was born into Coptic Christianity, that he would stay a Coptic Christian.
The overwhelming probability was that he would. The odds are that he would remain a Coptic Christian.
Okay, the odds are. So is it possible that a person, if a person is born in a place where they learn math, and they learn that 2 + 2 = 4, and they stick with that their whole life, are they wrong for sticking with that?
No.
Okay.
But again, that's, you're making a false dichotomy is what that is. You're comparing math to beliefs, and that's, math is the one thing that we absolutely have proofs for. That's the one thing that is a constant, math and sound and physics, right? So you can't compare the two. It's comparing apples to oranges, really. But to the point is, if you believe, a better example would be believing that 2 + 2 = 5.
All right, I'll give you one that's not mathematical. If you are born into society where you think that germs can be spread from one person to another person, and you continue to believe that throughout your life, is that a legitimate belief? Even though you're born into society where it is believed?
Well, based on our current understanding, yes, it would be, but even a broken clock is right twice a day, right? Just because you accidentally were raised in an environment that has the actual facts when you discover it, doesn't mean you were right the whole wrong. It just means you accidentally believed the right thing.
Right. So if the audience that you just asked, they were born in the United States of America, and it's right that there is a God, and they still hold to that conclusion, then they would be doing something that's right, if that was the case.
Right to them, yes. I would agree with that. It is right to them. And if we were in Tehran right now, you would be defending Allah, and I would be trying to say that Allah doesn't exist, and you would be saying if they were born in Tehran and believed in Allah and Muhammad, that they would be right. We're victims of geography. That's all it is. And if it turns out that the Christian God actually is the God that exists, congratulations on being lucky enough to be born in the United States.
And congratulations on following the evidence where it leads to stay in that idea, because there are lots of people who leave that idea, not based on the evidence, but based on something else. And just as far as that statement goes, did you hear it? He said, if it turns out that the God of the Bible is the right God, then congratulations, you're right. What did he say he was going to be doing here tonight? Showing us that the God of the Bible cannot even be possible, and he just admitted, well, if it turns out that
the word if.
If it does, so you're admitting the possibility there now.
Yeah, but possibility is irrelevant, as I've already said.
If we move this, and I would like to say, if we move this to Tehran, I would still affirm that the God of the Bible is the right God. So if we move locations, I'll
not if you were born and raised in Tehran, sir.
I'm sorry, I would give credit to whoever asked the question, but it's not on here. But a question has been asked. What makes your God real, but not the hundreds or thousands of gods that have existed through time, i.e. Zeus from Greek mythology, etc.?
Sure, and that's a very good question. The fact that there are some non-authentic reproductions of something never cast doubt on the idea that there is actually an original. So if we said, you know, there are lots of fake Rembrandts around, and that shows that Rembrandt never painted an original, you would see that there's a fallacy involved there. The fallacy is that just because you can knock down several things doesn't mean you can knock down all of those. So if you're going to ask me, what could I present to you that would show that my God is the true God and the others are not,
then of course that would take much longer than we have this evening. But I would suggest, number one, the things that we can look at in this material, this physical world, match the traits of the God of the Bible perfectly. What I mean by that is, if you're going to look at the design that is inherent in the physical world, then you know that whatever supernatural being was there had to have an intelligence that's superior to humans. If you're going to look at the idea that there had to be a cause, but it couldn't be natural, it had to be supernatural, that would fit with the traits of the God of the Bible. And then I would take us farther into understanding that God knew that this question was going to be asked. He presented evidence on numerous occasions that was physical, miraculous evidence, but then he housed the falsifiability in his son Jesus Christ. So in Jesus, you see a manifestation of the God of the Bible who comes, lives, dies, comes back from the grave, and says, here is this life, my life, a perfectly moral life that is totally in line with objective morality, that shows the God that I am is the true God, as opposed to all those other gods in Athens when Paul stood up and said, you're very religious, but the God that you don't know about, that's the one I'm going to tell you about. There's plenty of evidence for the God of the Bible, and that would take us longer than we've got tonight. Very good question.
Again, I would encourage you to go and actually research this so-called evidence for the God of the Bible, because it doesn't exist. It is all hypothetical. The arguments and the evidence that's presented is the exact same evidence that I hear from imams, and which are leaders of Islam, religious leaders of Islam. It is the same arguments I hear from Hindu priests, etc. They're the exact same arguments. They will say exactly what Mr. Budd is saying. Hey, so again, it goes back to the same premise I offered earlier. You do not believe in 4,000 gods. I don't believe in 4,001. That's the only difference between the two of us.
Question for Blair. When did you realize that there is no God, and what experience led you to this?
Oh, wow, that's a good question. There's no catalyst. There's no one single event. You know, it's like I tell people, if I can change your mind about religion in a single hour, where's that coming from? You're too fickle. Okay, I mean, you're too fickle. This is not a decision that takes place in an hour. This is a decision that for some people takes months, years, and even decades. My mom and I debated this issue for 7 years, and the best I was able to do with my mom was turn her in from a Southern Baptist to a deist, right? Okay, I mean, this is something that is still going on, and my mom still have great conversations about religion and deism and belief in God, etc. I can go back to somewhere between the 6th and 7th grade was when I really began questioning and really began trying to understand why I didn't get it. My friends were Christian, my parents were Christian, my neighbors were Christian, so why didn't I get it? And I thought something was wrong with me. I really honestly thought there must be something wrong with me that I'm not getting. It's a problem inherent in me. Around the 7th grade, I kind of just gave up and you know, basically said the heck with it. And in my late teens, I first heard the word atheism. I started to really do some more research, look into theology. I read the Bible, the Quran, the Bhagavad Gita, the books of Zoroastrianism, etc. I got to study, travel to Europe and North Africa and the Middle East. I got to visit all the religious sites of Christianity, etc. And that just solidified my atheism. It made me realize that, this is not an atheist versus Christian world. There's a rainbow of religious beliefs out there, and they can't all be wrong. But they could all be, or they can't all be right, but they could all be wrong.
Let me just go very briefly back to the previous question. He said, the evidence that I'm presenting is the exact same evidence that you would get from an imam, that you would get from Hindu, the life of Jesus is not the same evidence that you would get from Hinduism and from Islam, etc. So you can't say that. Now, let me just address just a very brief section of that question. What he would really have to say, according to the way that he has presented this idea of ideas are an evolutionary byproduct is he would have to say that I'm an atheist because it's an evolutionary byproduct, because that's just what I am. That's where my genes have taken me. That's the atoms bouncing around my head. That's why I'm here. I might be an atheist because I was born in a certain part of this wood. But you see, you can't then say, well, I'm an atheist because I follow the evidence where it's led. No, if you're going to use that kind of argument, you have to stick with it all the way through. And if we were going to ask, when did you realize something? Well, let's ask Frank Tipler when he realized that there was a God, and he's going to tell you, I realized it when I followed the inexorable logic of my own special branch of physics.
Question for Kyle. This is a long one, so listen carefully. You said, without God, there is no basis for morality. How can you defend the biblical morality of the God of the Old Testament, the God of Abraham, ordered his chosen people, the Israelites, to murder children, rape virgins, beat their slaves, put people to death for homosexuality, and stone to death those who talk back to their parents? Is this jealous, homicidal, psychopathic, homophobic monster really your basis for morality?
That question is, I would suggest, improperly asked, insofar as if you ask a question, have you quit beating your wife yet? Well, that is a question that you're trying to get trapped in. Yes, if you answer yes, you're busted. If you answer no, you're busted. So when the questioner says, is this the homophobic, murderous, etc., God that you believe in? Well, hold on just a second. What you said were the traits of this God are the things that colored your statement there. You said that God commanded people to rape virgins. That is false. God has never commanded anybody to rape a virgin. There's not a verse in the Bible that says that. It's ridiculous. It's not true. And it's a statement made to try to get you to be confused about the morality of the God of the Bible. Now, here's what I will say, and understand this closely. The statement about objective morality has nothing whatsoever to do with the Bible. So if the Bible wasn't here, you would still have Dawkins say there's nothing here but pitiless indifference. If the Bible wasn't here, you'd still have Provine say there are no inherent moral ethical values. It's not me who's saying that there's no objective reality without a God. It's the atheists who are admitting it themselves. Now, here's what I can say. And in a book that we have been giving away outside, in this book, A Christian's Guide to Refuting Modern Atheism, we go through the idea that God is malicious and commands people to beat their slaves. And we go through the idea that God is sexist and doesn't respect women like he does men. And we show that those are fallacious arguments that do not adequately and properly represent what was going on in the Old Testament.
I would actually encourage all of you to actually read the Old Testament.
Amen.
All of it. Not just skip around to what your preacher says on Sunday. Read all of it, and you will find exactly where it says that the army were supposed to go out and slay the Midianites and kill every man and woman who had known a man, but keep the virgins for yourself so that you may bring them home and marry them. You have any doubt that those women were not raped? Those women were raped. Pure and simple. They did not go on their own free will, and they were forced into marriage and raped every night by men who stole them during a war. That is in the Bible. It is irrefutable. Actually, go and read your Bible. I encourage you to do it. It'll make more of you atheists.
Question for you, Blair. If God does not exist, explain the possibility of the accuracy of biblical prophecy.
I've only got 2 minutes, right? Okay, explain the accuracy of Nostradamus. Do you believe in Nostradamus? No. It's the same thing. Anybody can go back and look at anything that somebody said in history and go, oh, well, it fits this, and well, it fits this, and well, it fits this. Anybody can go back and second guess these things and assign them to any arbitrary thing that they want to, especially when you consider the fact that the Gospels were written almost 70 years or more than 70 years, depending on the scholar you accept, after Jesus existed. Anybody at that time can go back and say, okay, well, we need to prove that Jesus was the Son of God, so let's go and say that he rode into Jerusalem on a donkey and a colt. Or was it just a colt? Or maybe it was both. Oh, wait, we can't get our facts straight. Look, this is the problem with biblical historicity and with biblical scholarship. Once you actually look into that, and again, I encourage you, do the research. Go study biblical scholarship and the history of the Bible itself. Who wrote the Bible, when and how and why? That answer will be answered for you on your own.
Blair and I have found something on which we agree. Go read the Bible. Now, I want you to, if you hear this recorded or you get to go back, I want you to notice what Blair did in the last question. I just can't let that go. He said these men were supposed to marry these people that came back from another place. Now, if you'll read further, you'll realize that they were supposed to treat them with the same respect that they treated a wife that they would marry from Israel. So if you're going to admit that these men were supposed to marry them, you're going to have a hard
time. That makes it better how?
It doesn't ever say you rape them, and it also says,
now
hold on, let me get to the next question. Now, he said, what's the difference between Nostradamus and the Bible? Well, I'll tell you what the difference is. The difference is the Bible has been around, at least the New Testament there, for 1950 years or more. You're looking at very close to that. People have been trying to refute it for the entirety of their lives and have been unsuccessful. Voltaire said, I've done such a good job at refuting the Bible, when I die, the only Bible you'll ever find is in a museum. Right now, since 1947, 9 billion Bibles have been printed and distributed, and that's only by the United Bible Society. The Bible is the number one best-selling book in the world every single week of every single year. Now, why is that? It's because the prophecy has never been refuted. There's a very big difference between Nostradamus and the Bible. Nostradamus was wrong, the Bible's right.
Next question.
Okay, one more question for each speaker. Kyle, as a young earth creationist, what is your opinion on fossils and carbon dating? Is science wrong in this aspect? Were fossils put here by God to test us?
Yes. My opinion doesn't really matter. If you wanted my opinion, I would certainly give it to you, but I think that we can do better than my opinion. There are factual scientific evidences that show to us that the old earth idea cannot and is not right. Let me show you what happens and has historically since the time of Charles Darwin. Charles Darwin was looking at life and he said, you know what, I think we could get it done in about 200 million years. And so from the time of Charles Darwin to now, the age of the earth has increased from 200 million years, between 200 and 400, to 13.7 billion. Now, on average, that means that every 40 years, science comes up with a new proof that they have of the new age of the earth. Now, it's often said, well, science is self-correcting. We just weren't right back then, and now we're right now. No, I would suggest that what they're calling is not necessarily science. Science. And I would say, in that instance, it's not self-correcting. It's self-refuting. If you had 40 years ago evidence that proved the age of the earth was this, and 40 years later you have evidence that proves the age of the earth is this, and 40 years from now you're going to have evidence that, well, what's wrong with the way that you're doing things? Now, let me direct your attention to several examples of young earth evidence. There's a very good book out there called Thousands, Not Billions, and it would show you some of the scientific evidence that shows you can't get an earth that's as old as the general, and I almost hesitate to say the scientific community, because there are so many young earth creation scientists out there. We've got lots that work on our staff, and they would admit, hey, evolution is religion, it's not science. We've got a video out there out front. And if you're going to say the scientific community, well, no, hold on just a second. What you mean is the, generally speaking, the atheistic evolutionary scientific community, etc. Do we have evidence that if things went right now like they were going, that if you're going to adopt the same assumptions that you adopt for the old Earth methods, then the oldest this Earth could be would be 14 million years, because the rate of erosion would have taken the continents all the way into the ocean, and that's counting for continental uplift. So if you're going to take the same assumptions that you grant to the old Earth stuff, then you can get all kinds of evidence for a young Earth. And the scientific evidence is there, and like Blair has been suggesting to you, I would say, hey, go check thousands, not billions out. Go check some of the young Earth creation science material out. I think you'll see it's there.
Time. Okay. He needs some extra time.
Yeah, I would. Please, by all means, go buy his religious book.
Well, it's not mine. It's from someone else.
Go buy the religious book.
And it's not religious, it's scientific.
It is religious. There is no scientific evidence for young Earth creation. It is denying the evidence. See, here's the problem. Let's look, for example, at one of the classic young Earth creationist arguments, the Cambrian explosion. Now, if I take the Cambrian explosion on its own, the logical conclusion I would draw is, wow, it was created. But the problem is there's all this other evidence around it that creationists ignore. Any evidence that contradicts creationism is ignored, is absolutely ignored. Only evidence that supports the views. It's called evidence mining, or anomaly hunting is what they're doing. And there's no evidence for young Earth creationism. The evidence for old Earth is overwhelming. And this idea that, well, science changed their mind every 40 years, of course we do, because technology increases and the ability to look deeper increases and our knowledge expands. You know, before we could only look a mile down into the Earth and we could see, okay, that's 200,000 years, or now it's 200 million. Well, now we can go miles and miles and miles and look at all the strata, and we can look and we have the ability to age rocks. And I just want to clarify one thing in that question was wrong. Carbon dating does not determine the age of fossils. Carbon dating is used in archaeology. They don't use it for anything over 50,000 years old. There are other methods, iridium dating and stuff like that, for things that are older than that. So the question was actually started off with a false premise.
Last question for Blair. What do you mean by atheism can't be proved except in mathematics?
I didn't say that. I said the only thing that where you can prove a negative is in mathematics, is what I said. So I can't really answer that question because I didn't say that.
Okay.
We'll move to closing.
He said, hold on just a second. I got a response.
Got
to that. No, I'm just kidding. Atheism certainly can't be proved mathematically, and I think what we've seen tonight is it can't be proved philosophically. It can't be proved, period. I'd like to go back to... I'd like to just very, very briefly, if I got about 20 seconds left, and go back to that previous statement that he made about that previous question. He said, yeah, well, of course scientists change their mind. I mean, we can look further. We can see different things. So if scientists change their mind, and if right now they're telling you that the Earth is 13.7 billion years old, and they have evidence to prove that, and they change their mind and tell you something different later, then what are they doing? They're admitting they didn't ever have the evidence to prove that in the first place. Thanks.
We'll have a 5-minute closing statement from each speaker. Blair?
The evidence doesn't change. We just find new evidence that modifies the view of the existing evidence. That's the way science works. Think about an engine for a second. I mean, if we went by Kyle's analogy, if you will, we'd still be stuck with the horseless carriage. But science learns new ways and learns new technologies and builds upon it, and now we have Porsches and Lamborghinis and jet airplanes. Hey, this is the same thing with every other aspect of science: geology, seismology, archaeology, anthropology, sociology, etc., etc., etc. We always build on the existing data, we learn something new, and we have to modify the view that data held at first. And if the view cannot be maintained, it gets thrown out. One of the biggest achievements a scientist can make is to prove an existing theory wrong. You prove evolution wrong, congratulations, you're a Nobel Prize winning scientist. Still waiting. Anybody? Class? Bueller? It's not going to happen. Every time that somebody goes to prove evolution wrong or to prove old Earth creation, old Earth wrong, what they end up doing is proving it right. They add more evidence to the pile, and then that is tuned up a little bit to adjust for that evidence or thrown out completely. I'm going to go back to what I said originally. Go home and do the research on your own. Chances are the overwhelming majority of you have read nothing but Christian books. I'd encourage you to pick up Dawkins or Harris or Dennett. I would encourage you to read a college-level biology 101 textbook. If all you've read is creationist web pages or were homeschooled by creationists, the information is out there. Don't be afraid to question your existing beliefs. I've read most of the apologetic books. I've read William Lane Craig and all those. I've read them because I'm not afraid to question my conclusions and what I base my life on. I would encourage all of you to do the same. And everybody that applauded about the Bible, how many of you have actually read it cover to cover? Not enough of you. Not enough of you. Look, when Barna did their research poll, only 28% of Christians polled could say that Genesis was the first book of the Bible. Everybody else got it wrong. 37% said Billy Graham gave the Sermon on the Mount. Atheists almost aced that exam. Hey, so go and read your Bible and read a biology textbook and read the Apologist books, read them all, and come to a logical, rational conclusion. I don't care if you get done doing that and still a believer. More power to you. God bless you, if you will, okay? Really, more power to you. The point is, at that point, you can say, I've done the research and I have arrived at what I consider to be an educated decision. Don't let others tell you what to think and believe, neither me nor Kyle. Go out and do the research on your own and come to your own conclusions. Thank you.
I'd like to try to sum up what went down this evening, and I'd like for you to seriously consider it. Don't miss what happened tonight. Blair Scott said, hey, you're right, I can't affirm God does not exist. And Apologetics Press made that proposition up, and that's how it got here. Well, that proposition was sent to Blair. And Blair admitted and acknowledged that he would affirm that proposition. And in his writing to his fellow atheists, he said, no, I can prove that gods do not exist. He failed to do that tonight. He had admitted that he failed to do that tonight in the opening 3 minutes of his lesson, of his speaking there, and throughout the entirety of the debate. If you're going to come away with something from this debate, come away understanding that you cannot prove that there is no God, and he knows that and knew it before he ever showed up tonight. Now, he says, I would like you to think about all of the evidence and assess it yourself. Absolutely, positively. I mean, that's what Paul was preaching from the time he wrote the book of Thessalonians. He said, test all things, hold fast to that which is good. And he said, you know what? If you arrive at the conclusion there at the end that there is a God, well, God bless you. You know what you're going to arrive at? What conclusion you will arrive at if you're being honest with the evidence and if you're assessing it with a proper critical mind, you will arrive at the conclusion that there is a God, and God bless you for that. Absolutely, positively. Now, he said, you know what Kyle did here this evening? He threw out so much stuff that I couldn't even deal with it, and I can't deal with all those arguments, and so I'm just not going to try. Well, you know, I had hoped that he would deal with one of them. But he didn't deal with any serious argument that I presented. Instead, he used 5 minutes or so of his opening arguments to tell you that near-death experiences are not proof for God's existence. And nobody came in here thinking, well, I'm not going to say nobody because I don't know what you came in here thinking, but I'm going to say the vast majority of people never thought about using near-death experiences to prove that God exists. So if he knew these arguments were out there, And if he had time to prepare an extensive reply to near-death experiences, why didn't he have time to respond to one of the arguments that was presented tonight that's been around for thousands of years, like he admits? If they've been around for so long, where was the response to a single one of them? It was absent. It was conspicuously absent. What I think that we can come away from this night understanding is that, number one, no, you can't affirm there is no God. Number two, there aren't good responses to the evidence that there is a God. And number three, and listen to me closely, please, what we're doing here tonight really does matter. You see, if atheism were true, according to Richard Dawkins, this universe, there's not really anything but pitiless indifference. We would have to say that there's no objective morality, that whatever you decide to do is just as good as whatever the person next to you decides to do. And ultimately, we would have to say, you didn't choose to be here. You don't make your own decisions, and you are a slave to the genetic material that drives your every action. But that's not true. What we know for a fact is that your decisions are yours, and they matter. And what we're doing here tonight matters. And when our forefathers said that we are endowed with inalienable rights because we are created, that is still just as absolutely, positively self-evident as it's always been. Thank you.
Thank you. On a serious note, we have a few announcements we would like to make really quick. We want to especially thank our moderator, Dr. Olive, for taking time out of his day to be here with us tonight to put this event on. And of course, we want to give a special thanks to Mr. Kyle and Mr. Blair for taking time out of their schedules to put on a good show for us tonight. And we feel they both did a very wonderful job. Last but not least, we want to thank y'all for attending, and we want to thank all of those who are watching via live stream, and it is our hope that possibly you got something from tonight that you can carry with you. Thank you very much for attending. Please be safe and be careful on your way home.
We are just wrapping up the debate here at the University of North Alabama, and we want you to stay tuned because in the next hour we are going to be doing some analysis of the debate, and we are also going to be interviewing the debaters themselves. I just stepped out a few minutes ago and looked beyond the curtain, and it looked like the auditorium is virtually full. I scarcely saw an empty seat anywhere. They say the auditorium here will seat approximately 1,700 people, and so that means we were filled to capacity. We've also seen that we've got thousands watching on the internet tonight, and we are thankful for that as well. We're going to begin by interviewing Mr. Scott, and he's going to be out in just a minute because they are wrapping up the debate right now, and you can maybe hear the applause taking place in the background. But while we're waiting on him to come out, we're going to talk just a little bit about the debate, and I'm going to ask Dr. Miller. Dave, what was your overall impression of the debate tonight?
Well, I think both of the fellows were spirited and focused. You know, I'll admit that I'm a bit prejudiced in terms of how I think it went, but in my attempt to be completely objective and sit back and say, okay, is that convincing or is that convincing, I feel like Kyle carried the day.
Okay.
There were some moments that Blair had some points that perhaps needed to be elaborated on, but that's one of the drawbacks of a shorter format for a debate.
Dave, what would you say were the positives of the debate tonight?
Well, you know, we're living at a time in American civilization where people seem to be more preoccupied with just living their lives, enjoying their tremendous prosperity that has developed in this country, which I would say because of the Christian religion. And consequently, their interest, their spiritual appetites for the really important, earth-shaking questions of life, like does a God exist, their interest in that has waned. And even though we've had a tremendous audience tonight, I doubt that even the majority of the student body of this college was even here for it. So it's great that we have an opportunity to discuss these matters. It's always great to raise them in the public eye, and I would urge all of our viewers to understand the importance of that and to try to perpetuate publicizing this material, because you never know who you'll pull back from a purely materialistic approach to life and cause them to think about their soul and spiritual things.
Okay, appreciate that. We're waiting in just a moment. Mr. Scott is going to be coming out, and we're going to ask him his takes on the debate tonight. And I see him in the distance here. He'll be with us momentarily. While we're waiting on him, you mentioned the positives of the debate. What would you say would be the negatives of the debate tonight?
Well, you know, sometimes a response may not be as satisfactory as you'd like for it to be, on both sides, possibly. But in other words, more elaboration. Again, I wouldn't necessarily place that upon the speakers because of the format. They were necessarily limited. I thought one of the negatives was allowing applause.
Right.
And not only does that kind of create a psychological or emotional weight, it reduces the amount of time that the speakers can respond, because they were under strict time limits, and every time somebody applauds, that takes away from the time that could have been used.
I would agree, and largely the people who hold to creationism applaud when a point is made on their
right,
side and
right.
and vice versa.
Right,
looks like Mr. Scott is here now, and we are very appreciative of him for joining us tonight. Good to meet you.
Good to meet you.
Nice to meet you, Blair.
Thank you so much for taking the time to join
us.
We know that we have a very large audience on the internet tonight that has been watching, and it looks like the auditorium here is filled to capacity.
Filled to capacity, yeah.
And so that's
shows an amazing event.
Yeah.
Well done on advertising and getting people out and getting the word out. I know I did the best I could for my minuscule, probably 30 people sitting out there applauding for me. But yeah, great job on advertising and getting the crowd. I think this is a topic that needs to be discussed and people need to hear. I don't care whether you agree with me or not, but it does need to be discussed, and people need to think about what they believe, and that's the important thing to me.
Well, thanks. We wanted to ask you tonight, what was your overall impression? How do you think things went with the debate tonight?
I think they went good. I mean, everybody has gaffes. I think Kyle would probably say he had a couple of things he wished he had covered or wish he hadn't said, or, oh, I should have said this. We all do that. We all second guess and hindsight ourselves afterwards. You're like, oh man, I meant to say this or I should have said that. You know, that's going to happen no matter how many times you debate. But to me, the debate is more about the entertainment aspect for the audience. To me, debates are really about the audience. You know, Kyle and I are irrelevant. We're not the important people at a debate. The audience is. Those are the important people. And it's about what they hear and their engagement. I love audience Q&A when they get a chance to interact with the people on stage. I think that's a very important part of any debate, and I'm glad that was done tonight. And so as long as they walk away with something and thinking about these issues, whether pro or con, it doesn't matter. But the fact that you're thinking about it and having these discussions, that's what's important.
Was there anything that was said by Kyle tonight that surprised you that you
no.
did?
No.
Okay.
And you know, I fully expected the teleological, the cosmological, the moral argument. I expected all those. I know he called me to task for not, you know, going after them, but I don't see the point. you know, you can go online and look that stuff up, and it's there. It's there for the taking online. There's lots of people who are much more intelligent than I could ever dream of being who have tackled these issues. And that's all I'm asking is people go and look up these, look up teleological, cosmological, etc., and just take a look and see what the actual rebuttals are. Because these debates tend to boil down to those. And to be honest, it's a boring debate. I don't want to talk about the classic philosophical arguments. That's boring. These guys don't want to hear that. I want to talk about the science. I want to talk about where we're at in neuroscience and what's going on in that kind of world and stuff that you normally wouldn't hear in these types of debates. That's what I want to talk about. And I hope I at least entertained a few people, you know, and then we'll see what happens.
When you say, if I may ask a question, when you say that these arguments have been answered, can you think of anybody in human history that you would point to that you feel has decisively defeated those arguments?
Epicurus did a pretty fair job. He had limited access to knowledge, of course. You know, as science has advanced, we've been able to address these issues a lot more, God of the gaps, etc. But the basic premise of the philosophical arguments, you can go back and read a lot of Greek, especially Socrates, etc., and he touches on these issues and questions and delves into them and begins to break them down. And as knowledge increases, as science increases, and as our understanding of the world around us increases, they break down even more. So you have to read a cavalcade of people, if you will, to really get a good understanding. But if you just want a basic understanding of these arguments and basic refutation, that's a good place to start. I'm totally skipping on his name now, Epicurus. Epicurus is a good place to start. And from there, you know, I hate to use Wikipedia because it's not the best source in the world, but if you go look him up, there's a bunch of references to other people that thought along the same lines and kind of a chronological order from there, and you can follow that philosophical discussion and theological discussion. And both sides, both the Christian and the atheist view and also the deistic view, and all these views are intermingled in there. And I think it's important to read all of those, not just my view or your view or the middle ground of deism, if you want to say, but everybody's views, and get as much knowledge as you can and come to a conclusion that works for you. If that's belief in God, great. More power to you. I fully support that. That's great. I'm glad.
Now, we're not trying to put you on the spot here because you just had a debate on the subject, but it was a little interesting to me that you signed the negative proposition that I know that God does not exist. Do you feel like you proved that proposition?
No, you can't prove that proposition. You know, because you can't prove a negative. And to be honest, and I mentioned this, I was not up to this debate originally. I'm like, I don't see debates. I think they're a waste of time. The collegiate style debates, anyways. I think the debates that serve a better purpose, because remember, I've said it repeatedly, the audience is who's important. And the debates that I think serve the audience greater are these informal, where there's two people sitting in a chair, you have a moderator, and it's just a discussion back and forth. And there's a lot more time for audience interaction and Q&A. I think those are a much more effective way to present ideas and get to people to think about what they believe and don't believe, etc. So I hesitantly agreed to do the debate. And I mentioned this to Kyle. I said, you know, I'm not really keen on collegiate style debates. I think they're kind of a waste of time, which I also mentioned. And he said, well, there's a lot of people in Florence who were looking forward to this. And I said, all right, well, fine, I'll do it. I agreed to take on that premise because even though you cannot prove a negative, I think you can reasonably conclude close probability. As mathematicians will tell you, 0.99999999 infinitely is equal to one. So you may not be able to prove one, but you can prove 0.999999. And so, yeah, that's the approach that I took tonight, that it is a reasonable conclusion to say that God doesn't exist, in the same way that it is reasonable conclude that the Loch Ness Monster does not exist.
But technically, based on the proposition you signed, I know God does not exist.
Right.
You entered into that,
yes,
knowing you could not prove that,
yes,
knowing that technically,
yes,
you've lost this debate from,
yes,
the beginning.
Yes,
okay,
absolutely.
And, okay.
But, I mean, you have no choice. I mean, I could have easily hedged and gone back and forth with Kyle for months, and we would have never got anywhere, you know, and there's just no point in that. I agree with the premise. Let's go in. Let's tackle it. I'll admit up front that I can't prove a negative because that's just an impossibility. You can't do it. And let's talk about probability versus possibility and reasonableness.
Was this your first debate?
It was my first large debate. This is a very huge crowd. It was really exciting to be part of this. But no, it is not my first debate.
We don't know the exact number who were present, but based on the number we had, it looked pretty close to full here. That would have been about 1,700. Based on the number that we saw on the internet, we're estimating maybe 30 to 40,000 people watching. And so a lot of interest in the subject.
Yes, absolutely, there's a lot of interest.
So, Dave, did you have anything else you'd like to address?
Well, as you said, we probably can't relive the debate, right. So there's probably not much point in discussing that. But would you say that there's much interest? You know, you said you're a little surprised at the 1,700. Would you say that there's probably most of those people are theists?
Oh, absolutely. The overwhelming majority of that audience were Christian.
Is your impression that there's not as much interest from the other side? Why would atheists not want to participate or come?
Because we are a minority. If you look at the audience, it's hard to judge from the stage because the lights are blinding us a little bit, but I did try to block the lights whenever I could and look at the people in the nosebleed section as well as the bottom and try to get a gauge of, okay, who's plotting now, who's not, and just preliminary, clearly non-scientific, there's no way to know for sure. It looked like the audience was about even with what you would expect within the community at large, you know, which is 85% Christian and the rest either atheist or some other religious belief.
How could you tell by looking at the...
By watching the people that applauded when Mr. Kyle said something or when I said something.
Gotcha.
That's, you know, the atheists are not going to applaud when Kyle gives a rebuttal and the Christians are not going to applaud
right.
when I do. So that's how you kind of gauge.
Gotcha.
Clearly not scientific. It's total guesswork,
right.
but it looked to be about the close to proximity to the community numbers.
Just out of curiosity, how much preparation, or what did you do to prepare? Did you watch Kyle's previous debate?
I did watch Kyle's previous debate with Dan Barker, and that's one of the things that made me realize there's just no point in getting into the philosophical aspects of this. People have you know, seen it, done it. Go watch the Dan Barker-Kyle Butt debate. That's a good place to hear those arguments. I just didn't see it as a very entertaining debate by taking that route.
Okay. Did you feel like it was a profitable experience tonight?
No, I didn't make a single penny, no. it's absolutely, anytime you do something like this, it's a learning experience. Even the most professional, you know, diehard, been doing it for the last 50 years, will tell you that every debate they do, they learn something new.
Will you debate again?
Depends.
Okay.
We'll see. It's really a whim kind of thing. I do enjoy it. I enjoy online debates, email debates, and stuff like that. I do smaller public debates, probably more because we tend to stick to the Huntsville area. But I did enjoy this experience. I don't know. I may have the bug for the larger audience. We'll see.
Okay.
What if the proposition were changed to where Kyle affirmed, I know that that the God of the Bible exists?
That would be an interesting one. That would definitely be an interesting one.
So do we have a second debate lining up here?
Let's talk.
Okay.
Let's talk.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much,
Mr.
Scott.
Thank you. It was a pleasure meeting you, and
thanks
for pleasure to be involved. I really
taking
appreciate
a few
the
minutes.
Opportunity.
I know you've got plenty to do, but we're appreciative that you took a few minutes to let us talk with you.
I'm going to go hang out with a local atheist and give him a pat on the back.
So well,
thank
thanks
you guys.
A lot.
I greatly appreciate it.
Right.
You guys have a good weekend, and to all the viewers, a good weekend and enjoy.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, Blair.
Okay.
I believe Kyle will make his way toward us, is that correct?
Yes, Kyle will be coming in just a moment and we'll have an opportunity to talk with him. And we do appreciate Mr. Scott for taking a few minutes to let us interview him. Of course, at the Gospel Broadcasting Network, we do believe God exists. We believe the evidence is abundant for that. And we do think it was a profitable discussion tonight. While we're waiting on Kyle to arrive, I'll ask a few more questions to Dave. Dave, do you feel like the debaters stuck to the rules tonight?
I think so. I think that nobody took advantage, and I think they were trying to give each other an honest amount of time to respond to the issues that they'd raised.
You feel like it was kept on the level of gentlemen?
Very much so.
Okay.
Very much so.
Well, that's good. What about crowd reactions? That was alluded to a moment ago, and you mentioned something about it as well. Would it have been better for that to have been stated up front, not to allow this?
I think so. I really think in order, as I said, not only for the time factor, but to not interfere with the dynamics of the issues by, you know, making it. In fact, if it turns into a free-for-all where the audience is clearly weighted toward one side, then if nothing else, it does not allow the opposing view to be expressed as strongly as it can. You know, Christians have nothing to fear. We believe that we want the truth and nothing but the truth, and we're going to take the truth and follow the evidence wherever it leads. So there's no need for us to resort to any tactics or unkindnesses or jabs or getting personal. So the more we're able to stick on the subject and follow through a particular point to its logical conclusion, the better.
I thought it was an interesting admission of Mr. Scott that he said, yes, I could not prove this proposition. Mm-hmm. I knew going in that I had lost this debate.
Right.
I thought that was...
I was a little disappointed in that because, you know, I know Kyle, and Kyle would have been happy to adjust the proposition wording in such a way that he could feel like he could defend it. It's really not even fair to say, okay, I'm going to take this view and then turn around and say, well, you know, I admit that I really can't defend it.
Right.
So I would have liked for him to have taken a very clear and concise statement that he could get behind 100% and then prove his case based on that.
I think it's very interesting. Mr. Scott's obviously an intelligent man and obviously well-respected in the atheist community, but that he himself said, I cannot prove that God does not exist. Mm-hmm. And I think maybe that was one of the most powerful statements I've heard tonight. Mm-hmm.
It's interesting to me that whenever the discussion ensued about, you know, why have you believed what you believe? When did this happen to you in your life? You know, there will be no one who can stand before God at the end of time and offer a valid justification for why they chose to pursue a belief system that is false, that is unacceptable. And isn't it sad that so many times when people explain, well, this really started for me when I was a youth. That is so often the case with homosexuality and a host of other things.
Right.
When they're in an impressionable, formative period,
right.
Something happened. Things happen to them that kind of set them down a course that's right. Sad indeed.
That is interesting. We see that Kyle is here and he is ready to join us.
Gentlemen.
Are you now an atheist? Or?
I'm certainly not. No, as a matter of fact. I think that the evidence there again was overwhelming, that there is a God, and I think that it was presented in a way that I think showed objective truth seekers out there, hey, this is legitimate, this is real, and this is the proper way to reason through this.
Well, Kyle, we thank you very much for taking the time to let us interview you tonight. You did an excellent job, and we appreciate that very much. I will ask you some of the same questions we asked
sure.
Mr. Scott. What were your overall impressions? Do you feel like the debate went well tonight? Were you pleased with your performance?
When you start talking about what you do, it's always difficult to say, oh yeah, you know, I just think I did a great job. I'd like to pat
right.
myself on the back. But if I were to say, hey, prior to this debate, we had, I'm going to estimate 30 to 50,000 Christians praying about it. The overwhelming majority of prayers were for God's existence to be glorified and the Creator to be seen in what I said. And I do believe that tonight was a very successful, you wouldn't say attempt because I think it did get over. I think it was much more than an attempt, a very successful event that did glorify the truth that there really is a God.
I agree with that, yeah. It was interesting because when we were just talking to Mr. Scott, we were asking him about the proposition that he signed, that I know God does not exist, and he admitted tonight that he cannot prove that. And he admitted then going into the debate, he had already lost it.
He kind of also acted like you two would not have been able to come to an agreement on the actual wording, and so he just thought it'd be better for him to just accept that, even though he admitted that he was unable to really prove that. And I don't remember you telling me about your negotiations, but you would have been willing to make some adjustments for him to take a title, a proposition, that he would have felt fully capable of defending.
Absolutely. In fact, let me tell you how it went down. The representative from the Christian Student Center said, Kyle, here's the proposition that I emailed to Blair, and he agreed to. I was flabbergasted. I thought, no way, surely he did not agree to affirm there is no God. Because I know that you can't do that, and I know what his fellow atheistic people suggest, like Dawkins and Barker, and just say, no, you can't do that. So I emailed him personally, and I said, here's what has been sent to me. is that really the proposition that you're going to take? And he said, yes, it all looks good. So there was not any, hey, I don't like it, but I'll take it. Mm-hmm. Hey, I'd rather it be this way. Mm-hmm. Hey, I wish that we would word it here or there. It was, looks good to me, let's go. And I think that it was obvious that he understood you couldn't do that. Mm-hmm. That's why going into it, I wondered, how is he going to approach this? Now, I do think that it needs to be noted that when he was telling people on the social networks, on the internet, no, I can prove this, and here's how I'm going to. I'm going to prove that the idea of God is an evolutionary byproduct, and by doing so, I will disprove the idea of God, and I'll prove atheism. Well, that argument doesn't prove it at all, but he really did, I think, looking at what he wrote to others and looking at some of the other things that he asked, I do think he thought, well, that should carry the load, and it just doesn't carry that load.
Right, right. Now, Dave mentioned a potential of a new proposition and potential of a second debate.
You take the position, I know that God exists.
Now, I would be more than happy to take that proposition. Debates take me a while to prepare for. I put quite a bit of research into them, do a lot of praying about it, do a lot of asking other people to pray about it, and I'm sure people got tired of me saying, hey, pray about this debate. So any debate in the near future, I would probably maybe shift off to somebody else, but I'm sure that in the future we'll do some more. I did one there in 2009, about 2.5 years ago, and I expect to do more because I think it's a great way. Mm-hmm. You saw the interest. Mm-hmm. You saw what we had 1,500 to 1,700 people show up, and the groups that might not believe in a God were here, and groups that might be riding the fence were here. And it's very difficult to get them to come to an event that I would suggest could really make a spiritual difference in their lives, but that's what happened tonight. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, do I think it's good to do? I think it's real good, and I think I'll do some more in the future, but I don't know how soon and with whom.
We were just mentioning a moment ago that the auditorium seats about 1,700, and it looked like it was filled to capacity. And based on the statistics we were seeing on the internet, there were thousands of people logged on tonight watching. And some of those represented congregations where they had hundreds of people watching, and some represented houses. So maybe 30,000 to 40,000 people on the internet. So indeed, it made quite an impact. And we appreciate you so much for doing that. Now, we asked Mr. Scott about what type of preparation he made for the debate. Would you like to comment on that? Did you study his writings? Obviously, you quoted from him, something you put a lot of hours into. Can you even estimate how much work and prep time you did for the debate?
I guess I wouldn't be able to estimate, you know, the hours involved. I'll tell you what I did do, though. As far as the atheistic position is illogical. And so when a person tries to defend it, there are going to be times in his writings where he'll say this, and then there'll be other times where he'll say something different. Mm-hmm. And if you will read the atheistic writings closely enough and with an eye to seeing, okay, he said this here, is that going to hold on? You'll find the inconsistencies. And I tried to point some of those out. Of course, you can't do it. I had several quotes. I mean, you can point some of them out, but you can't point them all out. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I tried to read everything that he had, tried to watch every video that's on the internet, and see the logical inconsistencies that are inevitably going to come up in atheistic writings.
Mm-hmm. Was there anything he said tonight that surprised you, that you were not expecting him to say?
Not. Well, I will say this. I didn't expect him within the first 2 minutes to say, oh, by the way, I can't shoulder the burden of my proposition and let's move on.
Right.
Now, I expected that to come out. In fact, in my second 10-minute rebuttal, I had some statements where he, in fact, is on record as saying, I cannot prove there is no God. So if he was going to try to do that, I was going to say, oh, hold on, Blair, you've said that you can't do that. So I didn't expect that early on. But everything else I felt like was pretty much what he generally writes and speaks about.
One of the things he said that surprised me was you listed some quotes from a number of the most prominent atheists in the world, and he said, I would disagree with them on that.
The matter of free will.
The matter of free will.
Yes. Now, and he's free to disagree. He can if he wants. But the fact of the matter is they are being honest about the logical implications of atheism.
Right.
Really. If atheism is true, you can't have free will.
Right.
I mean, Provine comes on expelled and says to Ben Stein, there is no way you can have free will if there is
no God.
No God.
Right.
Well, that's not a straw man. It's not like a creationist is standing up and saying, okay, you can't have free will if there's no God, let's move on. No, that's from the very highest echelons of the atheistic evolutionary community. So when he says, well, I disagree with that, well, you can disagree, mm-hmm. but you can't logically disagree.
Right. The implications of disagreeing is atheism is false.
That's right.
Right. Dave, did you have particular questions for Kyle?
Are you going to be back at work at 8 in the morning?
I am not going to be back at work at 8. In fact, I'm going to be at the barbecue festival in Henderson, Tennessee, passing out AP material.
All right.
So okay. If anybody's anywhere close to Henderson, Tennessee, tomorrow we'll be at the barbecue festival. Come out and see us.
Great.
One last thing I'll mention before we let you go. I thought maybe the greatest line of the debate tonight was when you asked Mr. Scott if he had lied to us tonight in trying to make his point.
Well, I think that is telling when he said, yes, it would be all right to lie to make points. Mm-hmm. So there again, you're seeing the inconsistency of atheism. You can't consistently say, no, I can't lie. And he admits that he will. Ultimately, really, if atheism is true, you can't really say anything's right or wrong.
Right.
And you just get stuck. You
right.
get stuck in a public forum like that because, really, you can't defend all of the things that you've said in different places because it's not logically consistent.
Right. Well, Kyle, we think you did a great job.
Well,
we're very appreciative of you defending the truth in this way, and we look forward to future debates. Hope we'll have opportunity to air those as well.
Well, thanks a lot, Don. And I would like to say thank you very much for watching via live stream, and thanks a ton, GBN, for presenting this to the greater population here. And without you guys, we just couldn't have made this happen to so many people out there who could not get to the venue tonight. So thank you very much. And just one more thing, you just can't say it enough, in my opinion. Praise God for the truth he's presented us and for the ability to defend that truth. It's all his glory, and I'm just glad to be a part of it. Thanks a lot.
You did good.
Thanks
baby.
A lot.
Thank you, man.
Thanks a lot.
Okay.
We do appreciate Kyle very much in taking the time to interview us tonight, and we do believe Kyle did an excellent job tonight, and we think that the truth experienced a victory this evening as a result of this debate. We do have a number of things that we made notes about that we wanted to talk about specifically, and I see that Dave has quite a few, so I'm going to ask if you'd like to lead us off there.
Well, this is really just the flow sheet of the debate where I tried to follow the line of reasoning of each speaker. But one observation I would make is that in a debate like this where you're talking about a straight atheistic, theistic proposition, it's important for us to affirm very specifically that we're talking about the God of the Bible. Did you notice that Blair tried to go off on that direction? You know, well, what God are you talking about?
Right.
Well, the evidence for the God of the Bible is not the same as evidence for these false gods, because there is no evidence for these false gods. There's no comparison. So I thought Kyle did a good job of just pointing out that the God of the Bible, when you read about the God of the Bible, he would have to have certain attributes, and there would have to be certain characteristics of his created order. And when you look at the universe, it matches the God that you read about in the Bible, who is infinite in all of his attributes and self-existent. So my point there is that at some point, it's good for us to make the point to audience members that there is a distinction to be made between New Testament Christianity and the multitude of corrupt forms that have come about over the last 2,000 years. Because they actually hold views. You know, for example, Calvinism is not true, if for no other reason, because it misrepresents who God is. That's not who God is. He would not conduct himself in that way. And atheists know that. They see Calvinism and say, well, Christianity can't be true.
Right.
What they don't understand is that's not Christianity.
Right. I think a lot of damage has been done to people who are seeking for the truth because they see errors in the denominational world, and they associate that with all of Christianity. In fact, I noticed that one of the arguments that Mr. Scott was making tonight had to do with near-death experiences.
Right.
And he was talking about some things that he just assumes that Christians believe and would not be an accurate representation. And I know also in the Dan Barker debate, he was arguing against miracles,
right,
which also is not truly in accordance with the Bible.
And Kyle said, hey, I agree with you. I don't believe in miracles. And it stunned Dan Barker because he just assumed anybody that claims to be a Christian, and he came out of a Pentecostal background. So it's very important for us to constantly try to alert the people around us that there is a distinction between New Testament Christianity and the multitude of corrupt forms. Isn't it interesting that Jesus, in essence, made that point in John 17 in his prayer? He, in essence, was saying division sows and foments unbelief. So when you look at the evil things that have been done in the name of Christianity, and the Muslims and the Buddhists and the Hindus and the atheists point to that and say, see, that's proof that Christianity is not true. Well, their line of reasoning is flawed because they are assuming the Christianity to which they've been exposed is the pure New Testament Christianity of the Bible.
It's interesting. In fact, I typed down a comment he made along these lines. Scott said that all the religions of the world can't be right, but they can all be wrong. Hmm. But it was the first part of that that I thought was significant. He said all the religions of the world can't be right, and he right. made a correct observation
Absolutely.
There, because all of these different religions with conflicting ideas can't be right.
Yes.
And even all the religions that profess Christianity can't be right, and that's an interesting observation coming from an atheist, because a lot of people in the religious world believe that they can hold conflicting ideas and that we can all still be right, and that's right. not a consistent idea. We can't all be right, but that doesn't mean that no one's right.
That's right. Or the truth does not exist, or that you cannot arrive at truth. Atheism is technically simply another religion. He would like to say, no, we're the ones that are rational, we're irreligious because religion is the problem. Well, no, there's all kinds of false religion, and atheism is one of those false religions.
Right.
We have an article on our website written by Dr. Mike Houts, who is a NASA scientist, but a writer for AP, and the title of it is Evolution is Religion. And it's interesting that in promoting evolution, they try to act as if that's science, whereas evolution is part of the religion of atheism and should not be confused with true science, which is supportive of biblical teaching.
Right. In fact, talking about some of these things, the error of many religions that atheists latch on to try to disprove religion. There was something else that was brought up tonight, and it was a misrepresentation of the Bible completely to depict the Bible, the God of the Bible, as being an evil being, and I think he used the reference of raping virgins.
Right.
Kyle did a good job of explaining it was a total mischaracterization of the Bible.
Might I say that if people will go to apologeticspress.org, if they're unaware of this, you know, we have thousands of articles that deal with these quibbles, misrepresentations, and other challenges to the theistic viewpoint. And we've got some good material that deals with the ethics of the God of the Old Testament and shows how twisted and perverted those who make the claims are guilty of, because that is not the God of the Bible.
And that's a good point. In the short debate format that we have tonight, obviously a lot of material can be thrown out. Some assertions can be made that time does not allow every one of these things to be answered. But I don't know that there was an assertion made tonight that is not answered on the website.
Absolutely.
So www.apologeticspress.org, and you can look at all of this material and look at detailed answers, because there was not an assertion made that could not be answered, and the Bible has an answer to all
right.
of this
right.
error.
You know, it's a shame that if there were any young college students who themselves lean toward atheism or are atheists, it's a tragedy if they do not seek for the truth on those matters. Just assume that when somebody throws out something, hey, the God of the Bible, he orders men to rape women. If they don't go back and truly seek an answer. That's not to say that they won't go to a verse and take a surface meaning and conclude that someone like Blair Scott was right. But if they will dig in and study and make certain that they've understood it, Kyle well pointed out that the translation that he used, translating the Hebrew term that simply means to have sexual relations, and to translate it as rape, that's not a translation. That's a complete perversion of the original language.
Right.
So truth can be arrived at on that point if somebody wants to dig in there and find it out.
And a clear appears to be a bias in an effort to mischaracterize God.
Absolutely.
Kyle asked the question, do you believe that life came from non-life? And Mr. Scott's answer was, we don't know. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was interesting how many times tonight that sort of thing was said. He mm-hmm. said, I cannot prove that God does not exist. Does life come from non-life? I don't know. Mm-hmm. He made a lot of assertions. He used some illustrations to try to sway people. But when it came right down to proving things, he repeatedly said in different ways, I don't know. I can't answer this.
Which in essence was giving up the debate. Not that you have to know everything, but the very things that he said he didn't know or could not know, you would have to know in order to establish atheism. So this is not a matter of how knowledgeable a person is in science. It's interesting that he wanted to say, well, you know, these arguments, teleological and cosmological and moral, those are philosophical and you can't prove anything. There's no evidence for philosophical. I don't understand what he's even talking about. That's really the only way to prove God philosophically. And the evidence demonstrates that God exists. The moral argument, he says, has been answered for at least going back to what he say, Epicurus. Well, no, it hasn't. I mean, sure, Epicurus and Socrates and these fellows advanced ideas where they tried to quibble with those. But there's no one in the last 2,000 years that's answered those arguments. They still stand as bona fide, solid, decisive arguments for a higher being.
And it was very interesting because as Kyle started talking about these different arguments, the cosmological and the moral arguments, that Mr. Scott said, I'm not even going to try to answer those. I thought that was a very interesting admission. He said that people have been answering them for thousands of years.
Right.
If they have been answered, and he could powerfully lay to rest the idea of God's existence with these answers that he says have been around for thousands of years, why did he not try to answer them? Why did he not use that information? Instead, he said, I can't prove that God exists, and gave up the debate.
Excellent, excellent observation. If Kyle could articulate those, all three of those arguments in a matter of a few minutes, if there are bona fide answers that disprove those arguments, it would only take a few minutes to just give a quick response and say, this is why this is wrong, this is why this is wrong. And so I was a little puzzled that he tried saying such a thing because it can't be done. And I do agree with him on this. Go study them yourselves. Go to the apologeticspress.org website and type in teleological, type in cosmological, type in moral argument. And yes, you'll have abundant evidence and information there to sort those issues out.
And it was interesting, he said it maybe in a condescending or critical way, that he said the theological arguments haven't changed much in thousands of years. Mm. And what went through my mind is, why would they need to change if they are correct and they haven't been answered in thousands of years?
Absolutely.
Why would they need to change?
And again, see, in that sense, I don't mean to be unkind to Blair, but that was either a dodge or he mentioned logical fallacy in some of the arguments that he says are not legitimate. Well, that was not a legitimate way to handle that in a debate. He should have given us the evidence rather than just telling us they've been answered.
Right.
Dr. Warren used to say, assertions are assertions, and they're nothing more than an assertion, and they're as good as anybody's opinion.
Right.
You have to have evidence that demands the conclusion that you claim to be asserting.
Now, I thought he did do a good job tonight of proving that the Loch Ness Monster does not exist.
Yeah, I think he got that one right.
He talked about the Loch Ness Monster and the Tooth Fairy and maybe some others that I'm not recalling.
You know, Anthony Flew tried that same tactic with Dr. Warren and got nowhere with it. He dropped it as soon as it was refuted. And talking about reading things that are helpful, go read the Warren Flew debate or order the DVD from World Video Bible School. It's a classic done in 1976, and it shows too decisively how theism, when really theism goes up against atheism in a neutral environment, then the truth wins out. It's interesting to me that he said he doesn't really like collegiate debating. He just doesn't think that's a good format in which to do it. I don't understand that. What better way than to have two people that are capable of defending a view in an environment that you keep under control, where both sides are allowed to be presented as strongly as they can be presented. Mm-hmm. An honest person who's logical and going to operate not out of emotion but out of the truth, they can see those two views contrasted and see which one is the truth.
Sure.
That's a great way to do it.
Absolutely. You mentioned a moment ago Dr. Anthony Flew and the Warren Flew debate, which I agree was a classic, one of the best debates I've ever seen. Dr. Flew was a world-renowned atheist, and my understanding is he had a change of heart later in his life. Is that correct?
It is true. Near the end of his life, there's an article on our website about this, he did come to the conclusion there has to be some higher power, a purely naturalistic explanation, a la evolution, for the existence of the universe and all of these chemical processes is simply untenable. It's not scientific. So there has to be some sort of a higher power. However, he was on record as saying, I've not come to the Christian God. And so it was more of a deistic type notion without identifying this higher power as being the personal God of the Bible. And so far as I know, he died in that condition, which is a shame.
Right. Well, did you have things that you brought out? I want to give you an opportunity because I know you made some notes and some things that you thought were significant, things that you would like to comment on, and we only have about 7 or 8 minutes left. But
I really do not. Let me just make a comment or two, though. The question was raised regarding the historicity of the Bible and the Bible writers. You know, he tried to say, well, hey, you know, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John were written 50, 60 years after the fact anyways, and so they could have just sat there and said, well, let's try to, you know, come up with some way to make it seem like Jesus did this. That is not only a shallow, it's an inaccurate understanding of how the Bible came about. And again, this material, this is an abundant amount of material that would take some time to sit down, but it's not like you have to study it forever before you can ever get to any truth. The truth surfaces immediately. We know historically, this is a fact, that the Old Testament books were compiled and completed no later than 250 BC, because all scholars know that it was translated into Greek by those 72 scholars. Mm-hmm. So we know that all that was intact. So there's at least a 250-year period from there to the time of Christ. We know that Christ lived historically. There, numerous historians prove that he did. He's as historical as any other figure that we know lived historically. We know that the New Testament was therefore written in the first century. So there's no way to link those up accidentally.
Right.
Maybe here and there a person might accidentally, like Kyle mentioned, well, Nostradamus may have guessed some things right. But we're talking in the matter of prophecy. We're talking about prophecies in the Old Testament just pertaining to Jesus, not all the other, just the ones pertaining to Jesus, number over 330. And they're not vague like a lot of the so-called prophecy going on today. They're very specific. They're scattered out among 40 different writers over a period of 1,500 years leading up to the New Testament. And when you just start looking at those in the life of Christ, there's no way that that was concocted or accidental. It proves undeniably that this happened.
It was interesting with the comment about Nostradamus that he said, what's the difference in that and the Bible? And Nostradamus, some say, had an amazingly high rate of accuracy.
Right.
I would dispute that even,
right,
but
right.
Some would say that. But the difference is that the Bible has a 100%
absolutely
rate of accuracy. Mm. And even if there's any error, then we know it's not from a divine, all-knowing being.
Right. Another thing that disturbed me was when he said, well, you know, the Muslims and the Hindus, they all use the same arguments to defend their gods. Well, it is true that on the matter of just proving the concept that the universe does not have a merely naturalistic explanation, there has to be something supernatural. Yeah, they would use some of the same arguments. But that does not mean that the same line of evidence, that the same evidence that exists today would cause a person to conclude that Hinduism and the multiple gods of Hinduism are just as bona fide as the God of the Bible. Much of the evidence does not support that. Take Islam. If you go and study carefully the Quran and compare it to the Bible, there is no comparison. Mm-hmm. Well, it's not a matter of, well, they use the same arguments.
Right.
Now, there may be some overlap, but their system and their so-called authoritative source, Quran, does not compare with the Bible, and you can see it does not have the attributes of inspiration like the Bible has.
Amen. Well, we are just about out of time tonight, and we appreciate very much everyone who is involved in making the debate happen. We are thankful for all of the prayers. Kyle mentioned a lot of people who had been praying about the debate, and we are thankful for that as well. All of the people who tuned in on the internet, we're thankful to Dave Miller for being here with us tonight and being our resident expert this evening.
My pleasure. Let me say one other thing, Don. If the people watching this appreciate this kind of thing, they think, man, this is great for Christians to go to the public arena and draw in thousands of people and to debate these matters. I would hope that they would want to support GBN and support Apologetics Press, because here is a venue through which a lot of different people who may not have, you know, the local congregation, one individual local congregation doesn't have the ability to do the work that GBN is doing. But if a bunch of congregations join together, look what can happen as a result. So I would really admonish members of the church to see that as we're living in a country that is swiftly going downhill, we are literally in a state of national deterioration, decline. Christianity is being jettisoned. More and more of Americans do not embrace the Christian worldview. That's all the more reason for us to be out in the public arena, standing up, making noise, defending the truth. And here is an example of that being done. So I would strongly urge Christians to see the need. Even if the economy's bad, we need to get busy and pool our resources and do more of this.
And if you appreciate the work that was done here tonight with Kyle and this debate, it is going to be on a DVD for people to be able to get from Apologetics Press, and we're going to be airing it on the Gospel Broadcasting Network. So we would encourage you to investigate that, and it's available on the Roku channel, on the website, the iPhone, the iPad, and now on the Android. And we are just about out of time now, so we thank you so much for tuning in tonight. Hope you have a good night.
This has been a presentation of Apologetics Press, an organization dedicated to the defense of New Testament Christianity. Visit us on the web at apologeticspress.org or call 800-234-8558.